Hello and welcome to
the Sliding Door Podcast.
We're Atocene. I'm Adam, and we're joined with
I am Alex.
Yeah,
can't forget about Alex.
And today we have our first guest, Tyler from Fingerprints.
Hello.
How'd you get started with music? What was your like beginnings?
I was a youngin. I was like third grade, and my mom gave me the CD. It had like, it was like New Orleans jazz, like a bunch of different like cover songs by different artists.
Mm-hmm.
And like I heard the piano on it, like jazz piano. And I was like, fuck, I want to do that. So she made me take piano, and then that made me do school band in like fifth grade, and like all that in high school. And that's when I picked up guitar and bass, and kind of just followed with that from there.
Oh wow. Okay, so you have like more of a traditional background with music, like you've taking like piano lessons and stuff.
Totally.
Okay, so you know how to read music.
Have
you lost it?
I can still read music. It's just like if I go to play the piano, I can't really do left hand and right hand at the same time. Like I can't split my brain. The different subdivisions.
When was the last time you actually like sat down and like, I guess, read a sheet of music and were able to do that?
Yikes!
That was a long time ago.
Yeah. Okay. Probably before high school, so like middle school. If that.
So I'm pretty sure you're probably thankful for having that background to start with.
Oh yeah.
Right? Okay.
Now that ended up helping me out a ton
later on, right?
Sure.
Yeah. So like the way I got started was it was in high school, and I, you know, liking bands in high school, that's when you kind of get into music more, you know? You always, like, I feel like when you were a kid, you liked music, but you didn't, like, you were just, like, a little nerdy kid that, like, you know, like, for me, it was, like, the Beach Boys, you know? I didn't know why I liked them, but later on, like, I got more into, like, that punk phase in high school, and then I just picked up a guitar, and I never really took it seriously until, like, a few years after high school, and then I started, like, trying to learn a little bit more, and then in community college is when I took my first classical piano class and then, like, a music one theory class. So that's, like, how I got started. Like, that's how, like, I feel like before when I was picking up with the guitar, I was just reading, like, normal tabs. I never knew how to read music, but then that's when I started learning how to, like, read it a little bit more. So, like, even today, like, I can still, like, play, like, left and right-handed. And if I read it, I have to, like, read, you know, imagine what it was like reading it. Because I couldn't sight read. So, and then
that's
Alex.
That's serious practice.
Yeah.
Sight reading.
Yeah, sight reading. Yeah. Like, even that whole semester I took, I couldn't, like, I could do it very slowly, but I couldn't, like, keep up with any kind of fast tempo on it. But, yeah, and then how did you end up starting with?
I've been doing this for so long. Like,
yeah,
since
I was
a little kid. Like, I was, I don't know, like,
was
I
was it
just
drums?
Remember,
was it like drums?
Yeah, it was the drums. Yeah, eventually I got in choir, like, in high school, which is where I learned like music theory and all that stuff.
Yeah,
they would teach us about it, not like too in depth, but just like the surface, like
right.
enough to like kind of be able to pick up a sheet and like understand it at least, right?
Right.
And like
follow
read the notes.
Bit.
Yeah,
right.
yeah.
Okay.
Here's what a treble clef is. Here's
exactly.
A
yeah,
for sure.
yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And like the whole like face like
yeah.
and all that stuff. I remember I got my first drums when I was 12, and from then on I never stopped playing.
Yeah. Did you ever take lessons?
I never took lessons.
So it was just
no.
like
bass? I mean, I was like in music class like in school, but that's
yeah,
about
okay,
it. And
okay.
I remember I would play the drums for like the band right there when we had like shows and stuff.
Oh,
but it was very simple. It was like
yeah.
super easy, like
yeah.
super simple, like nothing complicated
mm-hmm.
or anything. So
interesting.
Yeah.
So you started off, like, the first live performances were at school. Was that where it was, kind of?
I guess so.
I mean,
that's
starting off
question.
Just playing in front
mm-hmm.
of an audience. Because, like, I'm not talking about, like, playing an actual show. But, like, even, like, the first time I performed was, I would go to open mics. When I first started out, like, songwriting, I would just go to open mics at, like, bars and stuff. And I would play. I would sometimes drag my friend to play, like, piano with me. But, that's how it kind of tested me out. And I realized that people don't give a fuck at bars. You know, they're,
right.
like, drinking, talking to friends. You might have one or two people staring at you, but then that's kind of where you kind of get your chops.
That's
where
why
you
got to play fucking loud. So
yeah.
They have to fucking hear you. Like, you force them.
But that was, I was, like, probably 19 or 20 when I first, that was the first time I ever performed in front of anybody.
Oh,
I was
for real?
Like, yeah,
okay.
I just invited, like, a coworker or something,
for
you
sure.
know, to, like, come along. But that was it. That's when that's how I kind of, like, seriously got started with music, so.
I remember being, like, I was, like, either 14 or 15, and, like, this girl, like, asked me to play at her quinces. You know that
thing? Oh, okay. Was it here in the States?
It was actually back in TJ, okay, okay. Yeah, when I used to live there, like when I was like younger.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was actually my, like, my first, like, show, I guess, like, to a crowd. Like, not even at a school venue. It was, like...
Okay, so it was your, like, first outside, plays, like... Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
But how old were you when that happened?
I was, like... Dude, I was, like, fucking, like, 13, 14, something like
Dang,
that.
Dang, so, like, you're just as old as she was, and she's asking you to play at her quinceanera?
Yeah.
Dang.
Yeah. I know, I was a little kid.
So, okay, I'm white, so I don't... Like, I kind of understand, like, quinceanera is, like, you're coming of age. Yeah. Kind of like a bar mitzvah, kind of, right? But, like... Is it, like, a super big deal?
Yeah, for some people it is. It's a trip. Like, it's a trip.
That would freak me out. Like, if I was 13 and said, hey, come play my kids here, I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
I guess, but, like, I already known her, so, like, the girl, so yeah. It was, like, whatever. I honestly might have been a little older. I'd say, like, 14, maybe. Yeah, like, around that age, probably. Because I remember she was, like, the same grade, and she was 15, but I'm pretty sure I was, like, 14, something like that. But yeah, it was just funny. Like,
yeah,
we even like dress up the same and shit, like the costume and everything. Right. Like, there's like a fucking video there somewhere, like on Facebook, but I lost it.
Oh, when you played, somebody like deleted
that's my childhood. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah,
oh, that's cool.
It's
man.
Gone forever.
Well, you say it's funny because you say you're white. I feel like I'm like halfway between like being like totally Americanized, where like I was born here with like no like other culture versus. Cause I think Alex, you were you born in Mexico in TJ?
No, I was born here.
Okay,
in, like,
so
in Mexico City.
But like, where'd you grow up most of your childhood? Were you coming back and forth? Like, did you come here for school or?
I used to. It was funny because like when I was 12, I moved here, but I still went to school over there. If that made sense.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
Yeah.
So you had like dual citizenship or?
Actually, no. I think I'm, like, only American now.
Oh, okay.
Like, I mean, I used to be for my parents because they were born there, but they immigrated, and, like, they're, like, citizens now, so it's kind of, like,
yeah.
Like, I don't have a citizenship, in, like, in Mexico or anything.
Okay, yeah. Sweet, yeah.
Like, I don't have any, literally, like, when I go there, like, they think I'm, like, American or whatever,
yeah.
Right?
But you speak so...
Even though I, like, yeah, even though, like,
you
I...
speak Spanish.
Yeah, I speak Spanish, and, like, sometimes, like, my accent does come out, especially when I'm drunk.
Wait, your accent comes, like, your American accent
comes out? No, my, like, Mexican, like, I start kind of, like, mumbling my words a little bit.
When you hear, like, anywhere, when you start drinking, you start...
I mean,
you feel
like
you're...
There's, like, a threshold.
That yeah, depends,
but...
Okay.
But yeah, like when I go there, like it's like, dude, like I think I look like Mexican, like decently Mexican.
No, yeah,
and,
I mean,
and it's kind of like they speak to me in English too. I'm like, okay, all right,
yeah. Now I've gotten like the reverse where I go to places and they assume that I am Mexican, but they assume that I know Spanish, and I'm like,
you know what? I also think it influences the way that you dress, dude. Because like people who are like from TJ and like people who are from here, like they dress a different way. Like they tend to like follow a certain like, I guess trend, but you still dress differently.
So like, what would be one of the things that you'd look for if like someone was dressing differently?
They wear a lot of like those I don't know what they're called, dude. Like, those like thick and it's not like rigged. It's not like cotton or anything. It's it's kind of like it's like a circle type of like.
Is it
like jacket?
Like the fabric? Is it?
Oh, like the flat.
I don't know what they're
it's like
called.
Snow jacket. It's like the kind of puffy kind of.
Yeah, kind of like that. It's not necessarily like soft, if that makes sense. It's like a different fabric.
I think I know.
They wear a lot
of
those, like the social.
It like zips up and it's like this big long sleeves and it's.
Yeah.
I think
like,
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, stuff like that. Like over here they wear more like. It's more like more brands, kind of like Nike and stuff like that. And then you do like even the style, like the short, like they go in shorts and stuff like that. Like over here, they wear like long socks here, like hats and all that stuff. And over there, it's just more like just like regular like blue jeans and like you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Kind of like I don't know. It's kind of hard to describe. It's kind of something that you have to like after like years of seeing the difference, it starts like being very apparent. So,
yeah,
for sure. That's a trip. I would have never thought that you could like tell someone like, oh, they're American from just now.
Yeah, or like you'll see like a lot of like Mexican families like you know they cross the border on like Sunday to come shop here. You can instantly tell like I mean I have that maybe that's just me that have that sixth sense, but dude, like you can easily tell.
Yeah,
it's like yep, because they I don't know they like come in groups or come together
right.
Like a very family oriented type of culture, you know.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
Interesting.
That's what I've noticed.
Yeah. But where do you come from? Are you born in America? Okay.
I was born in Orange County.
Okay.
And then lived in Chino Hills, like San Bernardino, until I was about 7. And then my dad actually got a job down here in San Diego in Mira Mesa, so he moved us down there.
Oh, okay. That's how you got here in San Diego.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
And so this is, like, I remember very little about Chino Hills, so, like, San Diego is more like where I grew up.
Right.
Because, like, that's where I had, like, most of my, like, developmental stages.
Right. Like, you went through elementary school
went
here?
Went through puberty here. So.
Okay.
Yeah. That's where I have all of the really hard memories.
Okay. No, I feel you. I feel you.
And am I wrong that... And you knowing, do you know German?
No.
What language do you speak?
English, and then I took French in high school.
Okay, so you know French.
I know how to ask for the bathroom. Like, I have such bad retention for... I don't know if it was, like, I just have a really bad retention of languages, or if it's just, like, I had a bad teacher.
Oh, okay.
It's like... all I remember, I had the weirdest teacher for French, because, like, she was this older lady, she was English... And, like, from what I understand, like, the English people and the French people fucking hate each other. So I was like, well, that's weird that you're English, but you're taking us French. So I thought that was fun.
Yeah.
But, like, she did these weird things. Like, one time she was trying to teach us, like, we're trying to learn the different words for the different parts of the body.
Yeah.
It was like, this one's head and these are eyes. And then she she's pointing to a diagram. And then all of a sudden, she has this desk in the front and I'm sitting in the front of the class. And she puts her leg up like this on the desk and she goes... Jean, like this. I was like, and right in front of me, like, right, like, she just, like, spread her legs right in front of me. I was like, okay, Jean. So maybe that's why I didn't pay attention as much, because I was just creeped out.
Yeah.
But I can't speak. Like, if you asked me to say, oh, can you, like, if we, let's go to France and let's have you translate for us, I would probably get us into more trouble than
right.
helping.
Okay. So English, you just primarily know English.
Right.
So you took a French class. I'm the same way. I think I grew up with, like, when I was, for the first 5 years, I grew up, like, around my grandparents, so I have, like, I know some Spanish, but I understand it a lot better than I can speak it. And then later in high school, I took 2 years of Italian, so I know a little Italian. So, and it's funny because people can't figure out, like, if you first, I feel like a lot of people who first meet me, they're guessing, like, oh, I thought you were white, or I get Italian sometimes. But it throws people off because my first and middle name are, like, pretty English, I guess.
What's your middle name?
Adam.
Oh, Adam is your middle name?
I thought
it was your first name.
No, it's my middle name.
Oh,
okay,
sure.
So my first name's Nathan.
That's
so
right, okay.
Because
you added me on Facebook, I'm like, who's Nathan Adam?
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck? All right.
So I started using my middle name in college.
Yeah,
when I went to
SDSU. A lot of people know him as Nathan.
Yeah, because
I mean,
a lot of the
like
friends I made before I went to SDSU, I just went by my first name.
Like, if I say Adam around, like, the homies, everyone's like, who?
Yeah.
So then why'd you go with the middle name?
So when I first went to anything, if you get a new job or anything where nobody knows you, you could literally change your personality and people
it's
won't
kinda
question.
Cool. Like I kinda get it.
People won't question it because it's the first time meeting you. They're not gonna be like, why are you acting different? You know what I mean? If you were like the cool Tyler and then all of a sudden you became like an asshole Tyler, people would be like behind your back probably talking shit, you know what I mean?
For sure.
But like they wouldn't question it. Like, they wouldn't be asking, why is he being like, oh, maybe he had, like, a family death or something. I don't know. What I'm saying is, like, I changed my middle name because, well, for a couple of reasons. I've never, ever, ever, ever used it in my life. Like, you know, throughout high school, middle school, my family, a lot of my close friends know me as Nathan. When I first met him, that's when I was at State. He was going to State, too, at that time. And, like, I was just so used to introducing myself as Adam that, like, I just introduced myself to him. And then we got into this conversation where his middle name
is
Alex.
Situation with me.
Wait, okay, come on.
Know,
you guys can't...
Mine's even worse. Mine's even worse, because, like...
Your story's worse?
Well, because, like...
What do you
like,
mean?
Like,
your first name's worse?
No. Like that. No, I'm saying, like...
What's your first name, fuckface?
No, sorry. They were asking me.
So
like,
that explains why.
Okay.
Yeah, right?
That's
why
I
never used
it. It's fucking... It's Christian. That's my first name. And then my middle name is, like, Alejandro or whatever.
Okay, but you use Alex.
I use Alex.
Okay, which is fine. Yeah.
Well, Alex is, like, the English parallel of Alejandro, right?
Yeah. It's like if my name was, like, Alexander, which is the same name as Alejandro, just, like, the Spanish version.
Right. Okay. Yeah, so that's... I just changed my name because I've never used it. I didn't act any different. It wasn't myself, you know what I mean?
Right.
But, like, everybody from school, you know, knows me as Adam. A lot of people I introduce... It's weird because if I'm around friends that know me as Nathan, I feel like I'm, like, I secretly do it because, like, I feel, like, dirty saying, like, my middle name in front of them because they're looking at me like, what? Who did you just say you were? You know what I mean? Like, you just changed your name? What do you mean? Like, you know, I'm betraying them or, like, I'm, like, somebody else to them.
That's funny. My middle name is Harrison.
Okay.
And for the longest time, like, in high school, growing up where I did, like, there was, like, six different Tylers. And we, for whatever reason, we all had the same classes. So, like, someone would say Tyler and, like, six people would turn their head and be like, yeah. So I thought about using Harrison, like, because people could ask your name in high school. Like, oh, what do you want to be called as? And I was like,
Oh, yeah.
This is my chance. And I thought about it.
When like, they're first taking roll.
Right. But that thing, what she said about your family, that was what tripped me out. Because I'm like, what if I bring them over to hang out with my folks?
Yeah.
Or if I, so if like a family function and I just call myself Harrison and they're all calling me Tyler.
Yeah.
So.
That, yeah. See, well, I haven't, like a lot of, I don't, okay, so I'm originally from like the Central Coast, like near Monterey, you know where that is?
Yeah.
San Francisco. It's like,
yeah, for sure.
Okay. So it's this place called Salinas, and a lot of my family, like, I come from, like, field worker, like, the people who work the fields, like, a lot of the people that came from Mexico, those are my grandparents, you know, the people who marched with Cesar Chavez.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, so, like, my mom marched with him when she was a kid. I don't think I was born at that time. I think he died before I was born. Anyways,
that's awesome.
So that's, like, my background, but she moved down here when I was, like, 10 with, like, no family, so I don't have family down here, so besides her, so when I bring friends over or something, like, she doesn't trip because it's my middle name. You know what I mean? Like, she's not, like...
But, like, if you had your extended family over...
Yeah, it should be... People... I don't think a lot of my family knows my middle name. Like, my... You know what I mean? So, like, that would be a trip. It's like, you know, if your whole family knew you as Christian, and then people were calling you Alex, would they, like...
Yeah, no one in my family calls me Christian.
Yeah, like, so it would be weird.
Only homies... Like, only Oscar, because I've known that guy. Like,
yeah,
people would know me when I was, like, in, like, elementary school.
Yeah. Like, and Oscar's the guy playing
bass
for us.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, no way.
Yeah, and it's weird because the first time I met him was when the first time me and him jammed because we had, like, a show, like, the next day or something or, like, the few days after, and we never practiced before together. It's like, my friend Oscar, he plays really good bass. I'm like, yeah, you know what I mean? Like,
oh, yeah, he's really talented, dude. He can just, like, wing it.
No, yeah, he's like the equivalent of like a jazz bass where he could just improvise pretty well. Like, you know, if he knows the key, you know.
Was he improvising at the Che?
I think, like, he reviewed the songs for like how long?
Yeah, I think we just.
For like an hour.
Practiced like that day. But we didn't practice with the full band. He just listened to the songs and recording.
I was sitting back in the back of that room and I was like, wow, that bass player is really good.
No, yeah, I don't look at him. Like,
he's
90%
really
of the time I'm trying to focus on myself, so I don't really hear him. But, like, I look over every once in a while, and he's, like, grooving. I'm like, dude, this guy's crazy.
Is he, so, like, going back to, like, the beginning of our conversation, is he, like, more classically trained? Like, he'd had
No, he's all self-taught.
What? No way.
He's not taking any lessons, yeah.
That's rad.
He just has a passion for it. That's all
I
need.
He's a really good, yeah. So I was surprised. I'm like, yeah. And then ever since then, like, more and more that he's played with us at every show.
Everyone?
Yeah, every show.
What a homie.
He's, like, we just... Like,
he always comes through, but, like, he's not here, like, 90% of the time.
Yeah, he lives in TJ, so...
Yeah,
right.
He actually lives in TJ, so, like...
It's, like, really hard to, like, do this, because, like, we're... Like, he lives down the street.
I live pretty close,
yeah.
Yeah,
we walk to each other's houses, so... But, yeah, he's pretty cool, and now, like, we're recording, like, four new songs, and... We're like, Oscar's kind of like part of the band, kind of, right? Because, like, he's played at all our shows. Now he's going to be, like, recording on the, you know what I mean? But, yeah, it's pretty cool.
Sick. When is, you guys are recording four new songs, when is that supposed to?
Well, like, right now, like, what we do is, I usually write most of the material, and then I'll bring it to, like, Alex, and we'll kind of, he'll write a lot of the drums. And then we just, from there, we kind of, like, should we take this out? Who do we want to extend this, whatever. So right now we have, like, our last song. We're still going to be working on drums, like, this week. And then we just demo those out. Like, I just record it, like, really scratched up. You know, like, I don't really EQ anything. I just kind of get on paper, you know, to see what it sounds like. And try to get it as close to, like, what we want just to make sure, like, oh, like, should we not have this in there? But once we get those demoed out, I pretty much write everything, record everything, and then So then he, when he records the drums, he could listen to what's going on and just follow through on it. And then we record drums. Like, we'll probably record it at the studio.
Yeah, we usually just program the drums for, like, the demo.
Yeah, for the demo.
MIDI drum, or?
Yeah, just, like, I use Logic, you use GarageBand, right?
Yeah, I use GarageBand to record, everything, you know. Just, if you have, like, really good equipment to record on, like, the mics and stuff.
I think it's a very efficient way of, like, producing.
Sure. Yeah.
Because it's different, you know, you have to be really good, or else it does limit you in a way. Because you're not actually playing your instruments, it's not the same, obviously. It's never going to be the same type of creativity, right? But at the same time, like, if it's a song that doesn't really need much more than, like, a simple, like, something relatively simple.
Yeah.
Then I think it works really good.
For the drums?
Yeah, programming the drums.
Yeah. And it's easy. It's you don't even need to, like, have, like, a space
big
where you
space,
can play
yeah.
it. Because he just does it on it, right? You do it on your computer, so
it's not loud at all or anything.
Yeah,
so.
And we instantaneously we get a feel of what the song is gonna sound like just by him. You know what I mean?
For sure.
So after that, yeah, we just so we're doing that like this week, and then we'll see if we have anything to like just smooth out. And probably within the next few weeks is when we'll start like writing like the master track, like, you know, recording all the master instruments using the really good, you know what I mean? Just like,
yeah.
And then, so it's March. I mean, it's almost one of those things where like, so I know you write your own songs, right? Do you record your own songs as well? Or do you go somewhere?
Normally, I just, like, I do what you guys do, and I just demo it up in my house, but for this next thing that I'm trying to do, I'm going to go to my friend's house,
where
he has, like, a home studio built up.
Okay, nice, yeah.
Sure.
Okay, so, in the same way, so you've used GarageBand, how well do you know, like, any, like, audio engineering? Do you just...
Actually, because I have a, it's not an Apple computer, I just have a, what's it called? Like a Mac?
Okay.
I have Windows. So I used Reaper as
well. Oh, okay. So you use a different program to record.
And it actually works really great for what I use it for. It has a really lot of awesome plugins. So
okay. Reaper's cool. It's
like,
free too, right?
Yeah. It's free for like
a trial
period. And then they have a student price, which is like $60.
Okay.
So it's really competitive. And it works really, really well. I really can't complain too much.
I think
Reaper's cool. I've used it before, like on my Windows laptop.
Yeah.
Wait, what were you gonna say?
I think the one thing about like, this goes for a lot of things, instruments and like gear, is if you don't have the knowledge, like I always use like the analogy of, if you take a really good guitar player and a really bad guitar player, and then you give the really good guitar player a really shitty guitar, and you give the really bad guitar player a really nice high-end guitar, like, it's not going to compare. The really good guitarist is going to fucking shred on that shitty guitar. So I think at the end of the day, of course, that guitar player would sound a lot better on, like, a nicer guitar. But the same thing with, like, recording software. It's if you get Pro Tools and you don't know how to use it, the person using, like, a shittier programming recording program
is, might sound better.
Yeah, because they know how to use it. And that's kind of where I'm at.
Right.
I'm like, when I first started just like writing my own songs and seeing how this works, I was using this.
Uh-huh.
You know, I've just learned off this and I've gotten so much better to where the last, if you've listened to our last songs, like he recorded all the drums on his own and I just took that and added it to like whatever I recorded. And I did to the best of my ability, like EQ'd everything. Used a couple plugins to like master it out, and you know, and went through like multiple versions of like the bass is too high on this, and tried to, you know, fix that out. So I've gone through a lot. Like, I feel like my knowledge is pretty high, not to like a competitive level where I could work professionally, but for what it is, you know, like, so that's pretty cool that you kind of like know a little bit about that.
Right. I feel like most people, like most DIY musicians, kind of have to at this point. Anyways.
Yeah.
Because, like, otherwise you're shelling out, like, thousands and thousands of dollars to go get someone else to do it.
Yeah. Well,
but it's not that hard, though. You know, it's,
right.
it's a learning process, but at the same time, like, I mean, it's very intuitive if you're a musician already. You know?
Yeah,
like,
you kind of have...
If you kind of understand, like, music,
yeah.
like, sounds and stuff like that. Like,
if you have a passion for it, you're going to learn.
Right.
You know what I mean, it's not
like...
It's,
yeah, and it's not going to be a barrier for you. You're just
yeah.
going to do it. You know, you'll probably like, get stuck. You're like, how do I do this? You know, but then you just look it up and then you
yeah,
learn how
right.
to do it.
Oh, man, the forums for stuff like that are fantastic. Cause, like,
yeah.
To learn to look up or YouTube videos.
Oh, yeah.
YouTube videos.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, YouTube videos.
I do that too a lot. Like, do you know about de-essing a little?
Yeah, a little bit. Like where you EQ out
the
syllables, right? Yeah, for sure.
I remember when I was first recording, I was like, oh, man, the song sounds so good until it gets the... Then it just... peaks, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like, what the fuck is that? And I looked it up, like, what makes that sound? I don't know, it's de-essing. It's just a certain frequency where you have to kind of EQ down a little bit. There's,
sure.
like, an actual plugin for that, but I think everybody's, like, that syllable's a little different for everybody because they have their different vocal range, so I had to, like, customize it for my voice or whatever, but that's cool. So you go into, like, a friend's house. So, what... Like, how'd you get started with Fingerprints? Is that, like, a project you've recently started over the last few years, or, like...
Yeah, kind of, like, after... my senior year of high school, I was in this one band, and then I ended up quitting, because it's just, like, it was way too much drama.
What did you do in that band where you was...
I was the guitar player.
Okay.
And we had a pretty decent run. Like, we played a few shows at this place called The Epicenter up in Mira Mesa, which was this cool little place for local bands to play.
It's gone.
But yeah, that ended, and then I had this idea for a song that I was going to use for that band, and that ended up being the first track on my demo.
Okay.
And so I was like, oh, this is pretty good. Let's see what else I can do with this. So I ended up writing a few more songs, and it wasn't like anything. I didn't really think I was going to do anything with it. I was just like, these are like songs for me.
Yeah.
So, and then it was after a while, I just kind of sat back listening to these demos that I tracked. I'm like, these are pretty good.
Yeah.
Like, I should probably
yeah.
go out and play these for people and see what they think. And so that kind of became what it is
okay.
now.
I like the name. It's a cool name.
Yeah.
Sure. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, I was
the first emo.
Yeah,
I like it.
Well, the first couple songs that I wrote were really emo.
Yeah.
So
I love
I like
thinking.
Emo.
Oh, I love the chorus. Don't call me. I like that. Yeah.
I was listening to
and
a
then
lot
you...
of a lot of Tidal Fight when I wrote
okay.
that.
What you do is kind of what I also... Before, like, I met Alex, I would always write songs by myself, and I was into, like, melodies. So, like, whether it was on the piano or guitar, I would usually just write the chords. Like, what I would... I'm not too fancy on the guitar as far as, like, riffs or solos. Like, I could probably do that if I'm not singing. Because singing and doing solos, that's a whole nother talent by
right.
itself, you know what I mean? So I think what you do is, like, on those three songs that you have out is kind of what I was doing, where I was just writing the guitar and singing, and then I would put some of my own melodies, whether it was on, like, the electric guitar or, like, keyboard. So a lot of the stuff you, like, I felt like we were in the same genre, you know, like...
Totally.
So... And now, it's a kind of what I do now, except we have drums, and then I've added bass to it.
For sure.
Know?
When you guys were, or when you were writing and producing that couple of tracks you guys have on Bandcamp, were you listening to Against Me at all?
Okay, so, yeah, I listened to Against... Do you know about Against Me
no.
at all? Okay, it's just like that's like acoustic folk punk.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Pretty sick. I was actually, because I was listening to you guys' songs, and I was like, whoa,
yeah.
It sounds a lot like what I was doing in this one. Are they listening to...
No, I used to listen to Love Against Me, yeah. And then I remember the day when she came out as trans, and I was, like, big. But, yeah, so I used to... I don't know where I found it, but you did a cover of it, right?
Yeah.
Of one of the songs.
What's it called? Walking Is Still Honest.
Yeah. Yeah. What is that one line... I want to go to a place where drinking, where there's something to do with, like, not drinking, and, like, you can still have fun. There's a line in that about that, right?
I
don't know
the
exact
line,
but... is that another song?
That might be another song.
Okay. Anyways, yeah, I love, like, I don't listen too much... I haven't listened to a lot of the new material from them yet.
Ooh, it's really good.
Is
it? The newest one with the, what's it called?
That just came out.
Shape Shift With Me.
It came out a few months ago,
yeah,
right? Yeah,
no, it's super sick.
Okay, gotta check that out.
Because, did you hear their last one? It was Transgender Dysphoria Blues.
I listened to a few
that
songs.
That one was killer.
Yeah.
Like, she came out, and then she put that out. But, like, she framed it in a way, like... Like, obviously, she talks about, you know, coming out as trans and, like, the whole transition process.
Yeah.
And, like, finding her way and, like, finding her new identity in society.
Yeah.
But, like, she frames it in a way where, like, you don't have to be trans to relate to it.
Right.
Like, you can put yourself in that same situation and go, damn, I feel for this.
Yeah. I think that's the beauty of, like, songs and songwriting is that you have a personal story to it, but if you... It's so interpretative that, like, somebody else could take it a different way, you know? So I think that could totally gel with a lot of people. So, yeah, but back to the point, yeah, I have a lot of, like, influences from against me and then, like, a lot of, like, small East Coast bands that some of them died off and some of them have made it bigger, you know? But I think at the end of the day... For me, it was just, like, picking up the guitar and just writing, you know? That's why, like, I still play with the guitar, because that's where I started, and that's kind of where my roots came from. Like, I would go to open mics all the time playing with it, you know? And it's just that it's almost a personal kind of connection, and, you know, that you have with the audience a little bit more than an electric guitar. That's just a personal choice, though. I mean, I would never, like, I don't ever not see me... play like with the electric, like who knows in the future, maybe we start using electric, I don't know, but that's totally where some of this, like the sounds came from,
for sure,
from against me. So
yeah, I feel like when I think of Adam, I think of an acoustic guitar and I think of
yeah. Even though a lot of like stuff we record has a lot of electric guitar, but I mean, we try not to make that like a super like main point of like the music, or else people are gonna know it for like, you know,
yeah,
fucking...
It's like, this is the acoustic band, that's not acoustic.
Yeah, right. Yeah, so...
I mean, not that's, like, bad, but that's, you know...
Yeah,
I get what you mean by, like, you don't want to be pigeonholed as, like, that band.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So, we try to kind of... I mean, probably a little bit more in these next two songs, the electric guitar will be a little bit more pronounced, but we still want to kind of, I feel like, keep it a little, like, raw and, like, in that sense where it was just, like, acoustic and drums, kind of how it started, you know? But right now we do play with a backtrack that works half the time because this thing's pretty old and, it, like, the disc drive for it slows down, like, halfway, so.
Yeah, that was the one thing I really, really liked about you guys' set was that you had that backtrack going on. It's like you had the headphones on.
Yeah, so, yeah.
And so that you have the synth line up at those parts. I thought that was really sick.
Thanks, yeah.
But, like, I also saw, like, I pointed out to you, I think, that night, where, like, there are songs where you, like, you got upset and you took off the headphones, you just played it without it.
Yeah, we have a few, like, songs that we don't use, yeah.
No, because the computer, like, that one's, it's kind of slow, so it stops playing it. It says, like, system overload, so I have to, like...
Oh, take it off.
But then it's weird, because, like, sometimes if I don't, like, click okay and, like, pause it, then it'll, like, stop for a bit, and then, like,
continue,
play...
like, a second later?
No, like, 10, 20 seconds
oh,
later.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So does that
And then
it'd
be playing, like, a part, like, it's, like, way in the back of the song.
I didn't know this.
And then, like... Also thinking, like, I'm playing at this point when all this, like, all this thinking is going...
Oh, I didn't know that was happening while you were playing, like...
Yeah, I have to be like...
At the end of the day, dude, I'm just having fun up there. If something bad happens, like...
Yeah.
I remember we played one show, you know Deep Yogurt at all, Trevor?
I've heard of them.
Okay, so...
We need to go out to, like, a house show down here.
Oh, there's one that's gonna be happening, I think, Saturday. If you're down to go.
You know what? I might actually be free Saturday.
I mean, I was thinking of going to that one because I haven't seen him in a while. What was I saying? We played at his house, I think, late last year. So we play with the backtrack. So I'm always, like, waiting for him to either count in or something. And there was this one song where he started super fast that the song doesn't start off fast. Like, the drum beat, he came on, like, super fast. But, like, the tempo was right. It was just, like, the actual, like, beat came on. Like, it was, like, double time or something.
It was, yeah. No, it was, like, it was just more intense than it should have been.
Yeah, so, like, it starts off a little, like, smoother, and he just came in fast. It was just funny how sometimes, like...
But then I
slowed it down. Yeah,
and
it was just
everything
fun.
Fell into place. But honestly, because when when we actually nail, like, the, like, having the synth and when everything works out and it's loud and people can hear it. Because also, like, another big problem is that...
Yeah, we don't...
these, like, house shows, like...
Sometimes
the PA is fucking shitty most of the time, you know?
So, like...
So,
like,
you can't really hear the... Yeah. Especially because I hard... Like, I hit... I'm a hard hitter in the drums.
Yeah,
so,
he,
like,
fucking plays loud. Like,
so, like...
I'm always turning up my, fucking, amp to, like, overdrive, like, slightly, because I don't want to burn out the fucking bulbs, uh-huh. So just a little bit, just so you could hear it,
yeah.
And then,
like, at the Che was cool, because they have a decent,
yeah, they have
sound
a good,
system,
yeah,
so it's actually audible, which is pretty
right,
cool.
Dylan holds it down for sure,
yeah, he does a pretty good job, yeah, that's how kind of we do it, we just, any of the back tracks, we try to throw them on the computer as much as we can, and we'll play, you know, guitar, I sing, he plays the drums, Oscar comes, plays the bass, and we'll just have, like, some of the backtracks, some of the, like, the melodies, basically, and play to that. It would be cool to have, like a lead guitarist a little bit, you know? But I'm never, like, that never stops me. I think if that time comes, it'll come, you know? We're at a point where we'll write, like, we're off and on, we're, like, 1 week we'll write something, and then, like, that all kind of come together, and then another week we'll continue writing a part. So it's not like, I feel like having a lead guitar, like I write everything that's not, at this point, bass and drums. So all the, like, melodies and guitar parts, I come up with those on my own. And then we kind of talk about it, whether we want to, like, take it back or anything. And, but yeah, I know you do that too, so, like, is your next few songs gonna be, like, mainly acoustic with, like, other sounds, or...
I've been thinking about that, because I'm supposed to go into the studio the next month or so with this guy, but I don't know if it's, like, how I want to build this... Like, I know acoustic guitar is definitely gonna be a part of it, because that's just part of the
yeah.
Fingerprints vibe that I get.
Yeah.
And, like, so, like, I write everything on the acoustic guitar.
Right.
So I want that to be an element of it. I just don't know if that's gonna be, like, the...
The main driving force.
Right, that's gonna be, like, the you know... I don't want to say the girth of the sound, but
yeah,
it might play a big key in it, I think.
Okay.
You could do both. Like, have the acoustic in the background.
Right, that's what I did with
nice,
the
like,
demo. And, like,
clean electric guitar.
For sure. I don't know. Because some songs, I think, might actually sound better...
On the acoustic?
On the electric.
Oh, okay.
Because, like, they have a little... I don't know.
Or just, like, the vibe.
A little bit of chorus.
Sure. I know what you're talking about.
Like a
yeah.
touch of chorus?
Yeah, on the...
Blues like, driver.
Okay, so is it just gonna be like yourself? Is it gonna be the same thing? Are you like the only person right now that's, or do you have any live, do you have any people that you play live with yet, or not yet?
So far it's just a one man
okay.
thing.
And so when you foresee yourself playing these, do you see yourself, is it just you? So is it kind of like how it was last time we played where it was just you on the acoustic?
For the foreseeable future, it's gonna be just me.
Okay.
'Cause I haven't really met anyone that either isn't already in six different, like a drummer
right.
who's not in six bands already, or that
yeah.
lives anywhere close to where I live,
yeah.
that like we could like, hey, let's jam right now.
Yeah, see, that's a problem. There's so many variables to find
right.
somebody.
So there's that, and just if anyone would be down to play the type of music that I play.
Right.
And like, I would like to at some point have it be a larger group.
Right.
Where, because you guys are talking about, like, your writing process where you can, like, send ideas to each other and kind of bounce off one another, and that kind of drives the writing process a little
right.
bit. I'm kind of stuck with that, because it's just me, so, like, I'm super critical of, like, everything I write. I'm like,
yeah.
One day I'll be like, oh, this sounds great, I'll keep this line in there, and I'll walk up the next day, I'm like, this sounds like fucking shit.
Yeah.
So.
I think the hard part is, where is the point where you gotta say to yourself, like, this isn't good, or fuck it, like, how long am I gonna be stuck on this, just release it, you know what I mean? Like, it comes to the point where I've realized that you can't be writing an okay, like, album for, like, a year, or, like, not an album, but maybe four or five songs or whatever. Maybe you could do that for 6 months, and then you learn from everything you do. So even if you put out okay material and it gets better and better and better, if you put out like two or three releases over a course of 1 or 2 years, I think that's better than trying to perfect this one thing that you haven't really learned from because you haven't overcome those obstacles
mm-hmm.
over a 2 year span. So it's weird because like sometimes I'm like, I don't know if I 100% like it, but I do. Fuck it. Like, I'm never going to learn from this if I don't get past it. So, like, release it and learn from that, and you just get better on the next few songs you write. You know, it's hard to explain, but for me, I think it's totally where I got to be like, okay, like, this is the extent of my ability at this point as a songwriter. You know what I mean?
Right.
Or a guitarist or a singer or whatever. Just know that you'll... Just make that best product, put it out, then you'll learn from that. Then you'll be like, okay, I already did this. What can I do to improve it? Or else you're just going to be stuck on that same song. It's not going to get that much better no matter how much you kind of try to tweak it, because you're still at the same stage of writing in a sense. You know?
For sure.
So
it's like you put it out and then like you allow it to be where it is.
Yeah.
And not try to like...
Yeah, it's almost like,
It's like you don't want it to be forced. You want it to be a little bit more organic, is what you're saying.
In a sense, yeah. Because I feel like you're always going to struggle with... You always want to make the best product, like songs or whatever. But it comes to a point where you got to... If you haven't... It's almost like people who have experience. People who have experience have failed so many times. But if they never got past... that one failure and kind of try to like fix it at that moment, never got to a stage where they learned from that experience and moved on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like the first thing you're ever going to put out is fucking be this godly, like, you know, product, whether it's music or anything else, you
right.
know, so.
What was it? Led Zeppelin 4 was the one that had Stairway to Heaven. So like they already put out 3 albums that weren't, I mean, they were probably okay.
They're building up to
right.
it. Yeah. So, I think at the end of the day, for me at least, I can't get stuck on like one song. That if it's really bad, then I'll try to like, okay, trash that idea, but learn from it. But if I never got to that point where like I had to look at it from an outside perspective and kind of analyze it, then, like if I never reached that point, then I would have never learned from it. So I think, just write, be the best you. At that moment, you know what I mean?
For sure.
If that best you is what you put out, then you know what I mean? That's all I could kind of think of.
Yeah. Or you can get the best people to do it for you.
Right.
I mean, if you have money and stuff, and you write, like, poppy songs.
Or if you're persuasive,
but...
you know how to, like, get people to do so.
What do you mean, to write your own, like, everything?
Yeah. Or, like, not necessarily do all the work, but, like, if you know how to persuade people, you could probably convince them to, like, play with you and stuff like that, you know what I mean?
As far as, like, playing live?
No, I'm just saying to, like, write and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure if you have money and stuff. Because
you're saying... Because, like, it's tricky, dude. Like, because you're talking about, like an art, you know? And
yeah.
It's very subjective.
Yeah.
But if you look at it... If you look at it as, like, a business type of perspective, then, like... I mean, you always got to have the best product, no matter what that is, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, this, dude, like, I think at the end of the day, like, you're right with, like, what you're saying, that you learn from the mistakes, but at the same time, like, it's very competitive. So, you know what I mean? Like,
right. Like,
there's a certain limit
you can't
where you gotta say,
them,
like, I gotta...
See, but that depends on what we're trying to get out of it. Like, if
exactly.
you're saying, like, if it's just for the art's sake, and it's just for you, like, about what you want to take out of it, then maybe getting, like, the best out of what you want out of it, or what you can settle for, is what you're going for. But, like, if you're
it might not
for
be
the money,
best business
right.
decision.
Like, if you're
true.
Doing, like, pop music, and you're trying to sell, like, a million
yeah.
records, then you want it to be something that you can, because, like...
You
want
to
so then you work years on it, then, right?
Right.
Well,
or,
yeah, you gotta take your take and put in the
or
time.
Or, like
yeah.
you said, get the best people for it.
Yeah,
exactly.
True.
Or,
like
hire people to do it for you.
Right, like, what's your face? Pink... writes for a bunch of different people, like
okay.
Adam Lambert. All his songs were written by Pink.
For us, okay.
yeah. Like,
that's crazy.
If you ever listen to like the melodies on his stuff, like you can tell like she's written a little bit of it.
Yeah. Okay.
Interesting.
So
that makes sense.
It just depends
yeah.
what you're trying to.
Yeah, it depends. It depends.
Yeah, I think I was speaking for myself.
But for
sure,
because like for a lot of people, they like that like lo-fi like shitty garage recording, you know, and that's what they.
But that's
with.
Going back to what you said about like the guitar player with a shitty guitar. Like
yeah.
you can shred on it, and people don't really tell the difference.
Yeah.
It just sounds good anyway.
Imagine if there was a really shitty. I think I talked about this.
The trash guy.
Yeah, I live like. Where we're recording is, I have a window that's pretty close to, like, where our neighborhood trash.
Yeah, there he goes. Yeah, you can hear it.
So that's where that's from. And the window's closed, so there's not much you can do. You know what I mean?
Soundproof the whole house.
Yeah. But what I'm saying is, imagine if that lo-fi band that you really liked was like, actually they wrote terrible songs and weren't that good on their instruments, and it was lo-fi, then it would just sound like,
and it would just suck,
low like, quality shitty songs, you know? Which is subjective. If you like it, that's fine. I'm not,
yeah, exactly. Like, think about like a lot of like 70s recordings and like 80s, like it's very shitty, like it's,
right.
It's not on time.
No,
like,
no, no. But the song,
but that's
right,
that's a charm, like that's a charm.
Oh, yeah, that's
a charm about
part,
it, like,
part
like
of
people
it, yeah.
Like people like that, some people like
for
that,
sure.
So. What are you gonna say?
I was gonna say, because like that's interesting to point that out, like Husker Du in like the 80s, they like lo-fi kind of stuff that's going on like that, and people love that because it's like great songs on lo-fi. But then you listen to stuff like, I don't want to like trash these bands, or I'm not trying to trash these bands, but like Modern Baseball or Front Bottoms, where they have like kind of like a stripped down kind of, it's like they're not going for perfection, but it's like produced as though it were like a pop song.
Oh, I
yeah.
see.
So it's like, I don't know.
I
it's
mean,
a
that,
weird mix of
yeah.
A lot of it's, I think probably they worked themselves up to be get into like a really nice studio or something. Or, like, they got connections. So like, a lot of times you start off with, like, your computer. I mean, nowadays, you know, in the last couple of years, you know, a lot of times you do it yourself, so the production isn't there. Or, like, the, yeah, basically the recording software or
yeah.
the actual tools or somebody who knows how to actually mix and, you know.
It's definitely an investment, though. Like, most bands who make it, like, are, and, like, get huge, that's because they spend a shit ton of money on their recording. They made that, like, huge leap, you know?
Yeah. But I think the mistake is making that leap
too
early. Too
fast. No, you're right.
Right.
You're right. That's another
point.
Because
if you're not at a point where you think you're consistently making these pretty good songs, you know, then...
Not even that. Like, also, like, your musicianship, can't even talk right now, but, Because, like, if you're going to record, like, at a big studio, no, how good you are, like, recording, dude, because
yeah.
it's a process, dude. Like, it's not that easy. It's very stressful, you know?
Yeah.
It's work all day, like, you got to redo
yeah,
takes, and, like,
true.
And if you're working with, like, an expensive, like, say you hire a producer and stuff, they're going to push you, you know? Unless,
mm-hmm.
if they don't push you, then that's a shitty producer.
Right.
But they're going to push you to, like, all right, play this on time. No, that's not good. Come on, you gotta give it to me.
Yeah.
You know? And that can be very stressful. You know, it can be
mm-hmm.
fucking, yeah, drains you after a while. So, that's like, also another factor. Like, how prepared are you to do it?
Yeah.
Because
you
know?
So
they ask
so
you, dude. They,
yeah.
Like, the engineers ask you, like, how do you feel to record? Because this is not going to be easy, you know?
Mm-hmm. What do you mean? So, coming from me, I've never worked in an actual studio.
Okay.
I'm totally from the ground up by myself, learned everything. So, you've actually recorded in how many studios have you recorded
like
in?
Like, 3 or 4 in my life. Yeah.
And so, what's their... How do you interact with, like, the...
It depends.
The sound engineer? So, when you were saying... What do you mean about sound filter or what were you talking about right now?
Oh, like, earlier today?
What no, right mean? Now. Like, a few seconds about the filter of, like... Or, like, the
what
way they record...
Filter?
Oh, like when a producer pushes the musicians.
Oh, when they push you?
But you
well,
when you said, oh, they asked
well, it's
about
different.
How you filter record or something?
Or how you feel.
How you feel about
like,
the recording?
Do you feel good? Do you feel ready to record it? Like, are you confident enough that you
yeah.
can get in there and just, like,
mm-hmm.
go?
Oh, feel.
It depends. It
I
just
you said filter or something.
It depends on, like, how much help you get. Because you could just hire an engineer, and the engineer's not going
to
recommend anything. He's just going to record whatever you want
to
record.
Yeah.
He's just there
yeah.
to record you. On the other hand, if you have, like, a producer, the producer, he doesn't do a lot of the techie stuff. He's there to tell you, like, that doesn't, like, are you sure you want to do that? Like, he makes you question he challenges you, right? Or there are some, like, engineers that like to play, like, both roles sometimes, and they're
yeah.
like, well, maybe, then you know, they give, because they're engineers, so they understand, like, what's going to make it sound good for the most part. But at the same time, it's like playing an instrument. Like, some engineers are really good, some others are really shitty and very lazy.
Mm-hmm.
It just depends, like...
Yeah.
Which engineer you're working with.
Yeah.
But obviously, if you're going to be spending a lot of money, you're going to be recording at, like, a major studio or whatever, then you're looking into getting really good people. And, like,
yeah.
I mean, you're getting what you're paying for, right?
Right.
If you're paying, like, $3,000 for, like, a really nice recording, then, like, you better get the fucking best out of it.
Right. Yeah. Make sure you're on your A game. And everything.
Yeah, exactly. But if you spend, like, $200 or something, then it's not going to be, like, the most amazing production, you
mm-hmm.
know?
Yeah.
Or it could be, you know, it really
right.
depends. It
yeah.
depends on the music. Like, maybe that production level is good for your music and is, like, what it needs, you know? Maybe
yeah.
you just don't need that much production and that's how it sounds good. Yeah.
That's interesting. It's another take.
It's fun recording, though. Like, the whole process, the ritual, you just, you get
so,
there.
Okay, so, you played another band called Battery
Point. A Battery Point, yeah.
And
was that the band that just put out the music video with, like, the backseat of their car?
Yeah,
that was sick.
Yeah,
that was
pretty cool.
Oh, yeah, thanks, man.
Okay, so you guys, your past recording was in the studio.
We just recorded, but we're not.
Oh, you guys just recorded another
song. Yeah, but we're not going to release them. Because we were like unhappy with them.
Oh,
do you mind if I get one, dude?
So
thanks, man. Appreciate it.
Should we not tread in these waters or?
Cool, man. Thank you.
Yeah.
Wait, what was that? No, I don't care. I mean, we just.
I just don't want to get into like.
We weren't too happy with
them.
Like
a fun teaser.
Yeah.
Yeah, we. I feel like.
Oh, sure. I mean, no, I'm fine. I'm halfway through this. I drink beer so slowly.
I feel like we're gonna keep him like hidden like for a bit and then like eventually we'll release him. Well, we're trying to release an album first.
So that's pretty much it. It's gonna be like, okay, so how many songs did you just record? Was that three?
Mm-hmm.
So you guys gonna keep those for later for a bigger release?
I don't even know if we're ever gonna release them. I'm just saying what seems like the most likely event to happen is that we're gonna release an album, like it's gonna be pretty good, and then like at some point we're gonna listen to those songs and gonna be like, fuck it, let's just release them like a B side or something.
Okay, so
like
those
that, you know
are
I mean?
When you guys performed last, what you guys performed? Because I know you guys have like three original songs.
Oh, well,
right?
we performed those like right now because those are the only ones that we have written. So that's all we perform. Like.
Oh, those three originals that you guys just recorded.
Like, no, I mean the three
the
original
first,
and
the
then
ones.
Two of the newer ones.
Oh,
yeah.
So you guys did play the newer ones.
Yeah, two of them.
So are you guys planning to play those live, just not release them as?
For the for the time being, because
okay.
those are all the songs that we have.
Yeah.
So even if we wanted to play something else, we don't have anything else.
Yeah.
How do you guys feel about playing covers live? Are you pro covers or anti covers or like? Because I've heard different things.
If it's short and like people know the song, then it can be a good idea.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. But it depends, and but like it has to be just like a short. Like you have to play most original, like mostly original.
Yeah.
You know. But you can throw it in. It also depends. Like, if it's a very cheesy song, like, I would never want to go there and play, like, a Green Day song live.
Right.
You know what I mean?
What if it's
like not
a,
that I don't like Green Day,
like
but
it's like a lesser-known Green Day song, like something off, like, what's it, Nimrod or something like that.
I don't know.
Like, I feel like some
I know,
of those
I,
early,
go ahead.
Some of those early Green Day songs, or maybe,
like,
early... Like,
Warning?
Anything else? Early from, like, a band, it's the nostalgic sense of, like, I feel like if it was a recent release of theirs, it'd be a little weird.
Uh-huh.
Just because, I don't know, like...
Yeah, you would look like a fanboy or something.
I feel like those older songs come off, like, a lot different when you cover them. Because it shows that, like, this is, like, how the band started, and you kind of get the taste of, like... It's just different playing those older songs. It's almost nostalgic and, like, okay, like... It's not like he just likes Green Day. He likes a lot of the older stuff that a lot of people still appreciate. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
So we've never played any covers, but who knows in the future if we decide to even feature that on, like, if we do, like, another... We're talking about doing an album after this, but who knows? I mean...
Dude, what did you think of that? Remember at the house show where I played with Battery Point and we did that, like, the cover, the first song that we did?
So
what
I was there
think
for
about?
like to be honest with you, I was remember when you guys needed another microphone?
Yeah.
I was out getting it.
Oh, really?
I came back. I didn't come back. I didn't walk in until like that song was over because I didn't want to like.
Mm-hmm.
But I listened to it like the end part.
Mm.
It was New Order, or was it Joy Division?
I think it was New Order.
Okay.
I'm not sure. Or
no,
I don't think it was like a different band.
But,
like,
I mean, that sound kind of fits into what.
But
you
it, yeah,
see,
it has,
that's the type of shit I'm down for. Like, if you can find a cover that like just fits into your band, like it could sound like it's your own song.
Yeah.
Or that you put like a spin on it and you make it your own song. That's the type of stuff I love.
Because like it's not like
that's
everyone's
arguable.
Gonna know which song you're covering. They're gonna
right.
think it's your song in a way, and not that you're not stealing anything. Like,
so
you
did you guys?
Sure.
How much did you guys?
Practiced it?
Or how much of that song was, like, by the T versus you guys changed it up?
Oh, we did, like, a small version of it.
Oh, because it was, like, the whole song was, like, partial? It was
yeah,
just, like,
a minute and a half, two
okay.
minutes at most. Yeah. It wasn't the whole song.
But, I mean, I know just a few bands that have done covers of, like, songs that were of a way different genre, and they've put their taste, their own spin on it because of that... It's like when Blink-182 did the cover of Dancing With Myself.
Oh, yeah.
It's completely them, you know what I mean? But, like, it's still poppy enough because that song's originally poppy, and then they just put that Blink feel on it. So I think even if it's not in your genre, you can still, like, bring it over and, like, fuck, you know what I mean? Or, like, when Joyce Manor did the cover of the video Killed the Radio Star.
Oh, did they really?
Yeah, and they...
That's sick.
That song's, like, the lyrics are there, but, like, the composition of the song's a little different. Those two fucking... genres of music are completely different. So I think if you could, at the end of the day, make it your own and still sound good, then, you know.
Should be fun.
And if it relates, it kind of, like, relates or gives homage to the original in a sense, then I don't think it completely has to be, like, how you guys played, you know, that song. It doesn't necessarily have to be kind of, like, in the same ballpark of the genre of music you guys play. I don't know. I think at the end of the day, if it sounds good, nobody's going to be like, what the fuck, that was a disaster, because it's not the kind of
behavior.
Yeah, no one ever goes over like, oh, these guys.
This song.
Yeah, it wasn't like the genre.
Can't believe they played More Than a Feeling or whatever.
Yeah. So, I don't know. So
more
I think,
than a feeling, imagine covering that?
What?
That's
coming out playing Boston in like a house show? That would be something.
Like Dad Rock?
Yeah, come on.
But I don't know. If I think if you have the musical taste and you guys could pull it off and come to consensus that, like, okay, yeah, this sounds good, people will dig it, then I think anything goes.
Like,
you know, you can play anything.
Especially if they're drunk or stoned or something.
Right.
Yeah.
Or both.
You gotta go to a non, like...
That's why I like playing
venue.
House shows. I like being, like, one of the closing bands, because, like, that by then everyone's, like, already
they don't care.
Fucked up.
Yeah.
So they'll clap to anything.
Have a good time,
yeah,
sure.
They'll clap to anything. They'll like anything, you know? Even if you fuck up, they're like, ah!
Yeah. That's true. Man, okay. Cool, so when I mean, do you have, like, an idea? So you said you're going to hit the studio next month?
Right, because, like, he has a home studio, but, like, he's moving in the next couple of weeks. So he's kind of postponing. We were supposed to go this month, but we had to push it back a little bit. So, yeah.
Okay, so are you going to be the one just playing and he's going to be, like, recording and mixing it and stuff?
Yeah.
Okay, so the tables have turned, so now somebody else is doing your doing that part for you. That's
right.
Cool. Okay. Yeah. I think every time I think about that, I get to a point where I'm sitting down and writing. I'm like, man, I don't want to, like, depend on somebody else to, like, oh, are you free today? Or, like, you know what I mean? Like, I like having that power of just doing it right in front of me and doing it, you know?
For sure.
But maybe in the future, who knows? Like, if it would probably work when we demoed it out, and, like, from there, we already know what we're going to be writing and just go somewhere and sit down and, you know, actually write the final pieces.
My way of thinking of it was, because I tried demoing out some of these songs a while ago. And I listened back to them in my car. Like, oh, I tried to, like, produce them a little bit on my shitty laptop.
Yeah.
Because my room's fucking terrible for recording. Because, like, it's like it's a box, so all the waveforms cancel out on themselves.
When you're recording?
Yeah.
I built...
This guy has, like, a mini home studio. Like, he built, like, a...
There's a box inside of my room that I made, like, almost soundproof.
Oh, it's, like, all the styrofoam on the inside of the box?
So it's styrofoam... Okay, so my... Downstairs, it's carpet on the floor, so I didn't have to put anything. I got these wood panels from Home Depot, and I just put it with acoustic blankets. And then the top, I bought, like, Arlix, like, acoustic foam, and put some on the door where I put. I literally built, like, a little box where it has, like, a somewhat legit door with hinges. And because I had the same problem, and partially because I was living in here where I was screaming and yelling and playing really loudly in the middle of the night. So I had to figure out a way to do that at any time of day. And
not piss off the neighbors.
Yeah. Or when my mom was living upstairs, like, she'd call me at, like, 12 a.m., like, on a weekday. Can you, like, shut up? What? I thought it was quiet. You know what
Are
I mean?
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Oh,
that's why I built...
Can
you, like, shut up?
I thought that was just me when I would get texts from my parents. Like,
no,
hey,
okay, yeah.
Time to kill it.
Yeah.
No, because, like, it was that, and then, like I said, I would try to produce it on my laptop and, like in my headphones, and, like, when I first had it finished, I'm like, oh, this sounds really good. I can put this out. Then I go and play it in, like, my car, put it on a CD, and listen to somewhere else. I'm like, this is terrible.
Yeah.
So I, my way of thinking was like, it's cool to get a fresh set of ears that can like honestly and objectively listen to it and go, we need to fix this.
Like the qual. Oh, so that's what. Okay, so that's right. Part of it.
There's that, and plus, like, I've played shows with him before. I used to, there was kind of like a brief stint where we were in the same band for like a while.
Oh, so you have history with.
Yeah, this like person. I trust him enough to like, yeah, he understands the stuff that I'm trying to do. He like, he understands it from a musician part of point of view and like as like just a bud.
Yeah.
So
that's cool. That's cool that you've bonded in that sense where you have like the musical relationship where, you know, you guys can bounce off ideas. How many songs do you plan to put together?
Three, maybe four.
Okay. Yeah, depending on how the last one kind of comes right out. That's cool. Okay, so are you going to be releasing that? So do you have a Facebook page for that?
Yeah.
Okay, but you don't have like an Instagram or anything?
I basically just do Instagram through my own personal stuff.
Would you be considering like putting out a separate thing, or are you just going to continue it underneath your own like own Instagram? Or
I might. I might, so that I don't spam all my friends and family with it.
The reason, I mean, a big part why I feel like when we started this, to put it out on its own, like, account, was because I didn't have to worry about, like, bothering people with a lot of the stuff, or I didn't want to bother people who weren't interested, you know, with the post, because I try to post, like, 2 or 3 times a week, plus, like, this update that, like, oh, the new podcast is out. So I just want to keep that in its own, like, environment so it could grow naturally, not, like, through, like, oh, of course my grandma's going to like the post. Right. She likes all my posts, you know what I mean? So, you know what I'm talking about? So,
my mom likes my band.
So if I have 5 people that like it, most of the time it's going to be people who are somewhat interested versus, like, you know.
For sure.
So you're gonna be, do you just release your stuff like on Bandcamp or?
Okay. Yeah.
That's what we do.
Bandcamp and probably like SoundCloud.
Okay. I like SoundCloud. I don't know if I like the interface. I get lost a lot of the times on like,
yeah,
SoundCloud. Like you go to it sometimes, SoundCloud? If it's not even the same artist, it'll play like another artist. Sometimes it get confusing. Maybe it's just me because I do it on my phone and I don't go through the app all the time.
I think if you use
it on your laptop, it's fine.
It's a lot more.
Because I think it's made primarily for streaming on, like, desktop.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, but it feels like when you go to look for other bands, it's more oriented towards serving the musician and not the listener. Because, like, when you try to find other stuff, like, it doesn't feel like it's super efficient.
Yeah, there's something about it that I've never, like, tacked on, like, I've never grasped onto, so I don't think that's why any of our stuff's on there, but, yeah, it's cool. Okay, so
SoundCloud, if you're listening. Sorry.
Yeah, we have like thousands of listeners.
Right.
No, I wish. I mean,
there goes
I don't know.
That endorsement.
Yeah, I think we keep doing this because you gotta start from somewhere. You can't
For sure.
be like, oh, I'll wait till I have 100 followers and maybe, you know what I mean? Like, at the end of the day, if you gotta show up. It's half the time. It's like the karate master. The karate master doesn't become the master in one day. He showed up to fucking practice as a kid every day, you know, or every week or whatever. So we do these just constantly, and it's usually me and him. We'll just talk about random stuff. Do you do, like, you drink? Do you do anything outside of drinking, or?
No, that's I'm an alcoholic. No, I'm kidding.
I've been drunk for 2 weeks.
Yeah, right. I've had a constant low. This is my low week. No. Besides playing music and working and going to school.
What are you going to school for? Oh, English. That's right.
Right.
Yeah,
going
so.
To school for English.
Yeah, that's nice. Okay.
Waiting to hear back from either CSU Northridge or UCSD. So
oh,
I should
nice.
Be
okay.
Stressing the fuck out about that.
Yeah.
but besides that, just hanging out with friends and going on trips with my girlfriend.
Okay.
So
yeah. No. Okay. Yeah. I don't like. Besides drinking, and I've smoked once or twice at the most.
What, like cigarettes or like?
Like pot, marijuana.
Like pot.
Weed. I don't
pot?
Know what you call it.
Ganj.
The ganj.
Grass.
I'll call it pot. Nobody calls
the
it pot.
The devil's
alcohol.
Lettuce.
Just to be different.
Weed. Uh-huh. The weeds.
Yeah, I've never taken like any other psychedelic drugs or anything, so. It's interesting though, because if you think this, if you don't think it's natural, you gotta think about all the other animals that do it. If you think about cats,
yeah, some animals can.
Cats do it with catnip. There's I know birds eat like a certain, I think seed or something that does it.
There's like a certain
dozens of animals.
Oh wait, okay. You were asking if I like did anything besides drink. I thought you meant like as a hobby.
Oh, I mean,
drinking is not a hobby.
I mean, I wish it was, but I don't have the money or the time to be drunk all the time.
Oh,
yeah,
that'd be terrible.
Drinking. Oh yeah.
Imagine like being drunk for like weeks straight.
Oh no.
It's
yeah.
like at a constant bender.
Yeah.
Well,
you crash so bad, dude.
People
your
have
body would hurt.
Yeah, their tolerance builds with their liver, so they don't get drunk. Right.
They probably.
Like,
yeah. Probably.
They just need
yeah.
a lot of alcohol to like even feel something.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I don't know. What's your so you go to school? That's cool. You're gonna be playing. Do you know what you're gonna be doing? Why did you choose English?
Do you want the long version or the short version? I mean, we're on a podcast.
We could go long. I mean,
I started out at Miramar just because like I wanted to try music production, so I got my certificate in that, and then
you started off at Miramar because
yeah.
you wanted to do music production,
right?
How does that translate to English?
Well, here's why. Because like to get the, you know, the music degree, you would have also had to have.
Oh, it's a prerequisite.
Yeah, you had to have.
Oh, okay.
Well, not prerequisite. You had to take general ed just to get the associates.
And then you started taking English.
Right, I had English 101 with this guy named Professor Aaron Sebia, and his class was the fucking bomb. Like we talked about Malcolm X, and we read his autobiography. We read stuff like Jack Kerouac and the Beat Poets.
Okay.
And, like from there, I was like, this stuff's awesome.
Yeah.
Like, he taught it in a way, it was more like a what's it called? Sociology class. Or
okay.
like an American history class, which, like, I'm a huge nerd about American history.
Yeah.
And so he taught it in a way that was like, here's how this can reflect this. And,
yeah.
like, this is what was going on at the time, and this is why this played into. So I'd never seen, like, I always had a soft spot for literature in English, but I'd never seen it in that kind of frame. And so once he showed me that, I was like, this is what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
So I was either thinking, like, I could be a teacher, or I could, you know, go into writing and, like, journalism, or take that and go and do comparative literature and come be a lawyer and, like, help people out.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So it's...
Is that kind of, like, really, like, breaking down the super legal text into something that people
Yeah, just, like,
comprehend.
Taking it and then applying it to certain situations.
Okay.
So... I've always been a huge nerd for, like, arguments
yeah.
and debates.
Oh, man, we get into...
I like to argue.
Yeah, I think me and him get into, like... We don't fight each other. We don't fight each other, but we're just like, are you sure about that? And then I come up with something, and then he's like, no, 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 and then he'll bring up another...
So, like, you
example.
Call each other on
a little bit, yeah, it. Yeah. It's fun, though. It's funny, because when you're talking about American history... of course, I think that's... Most people have to take some kind of U.S. history and, like... when you're going to college or something. But it wasn't until I took in a
you guys
native...
You guys want a piece?
Yeah, I'll take one.
Hell yeah, wait.
I don't think I could eat it. But
I know,
thanks.
I know.
Is that a moon pie?
I don't even know what it is. Yeah. I stole it from work.
Oh, because they have the snacks they put out?
In the break room?
It's funny because, like, you work at...
Barnes & Noble.
So,
across
yeah.
the street.
Do you get employee discounts?
Hell yeah.
Like, is it 25% or what? Is it like
30% off the books, and then like 50% off the cafe.
So, oh, okay, yeah. So it's
super
not
cheap, dude. I eat for like really good food for cheap.
Do you read a lot?
Decent amount.
Sure.
Kind of like a habit, if anything. Like, yeah, I'll have days where like I only read for like just like 10, 20 minutes, but then there's other days where I read for like 2-3 hours.
Do you have
yeah.
a like specific type of like genre or author that you kind of gravitate towards?
I read a lot of Alan Watts stuff. He's a philosopher that I really dig his ideas. It's very interesting, dude. He brought a lot of like Eastern concept, like Buddhism concepts, and he brought it into the Western world. I feel like we've talked about this
yeah,
before.
Probably, yeah.
I also read out all the biographies. Like, I'm still reading Steve Jobs' biography because, I'm reading like 5 books at the same time. Like, I get bored of one,
oh,
then
man,
I move
that's...
into the other one, like...
Yeah.
Yeah, I like learning from other people, dude.
Does this ever happen to you? Because, like, it first started out, I was talking to my grandfather, because we learned about this in English in one of my classes. We were talking about the Irish uprising of like the Easter uprising of like 1913. And so I talked to that about my grandfather. He gave me this book about like, it's basically, it's like a history book talking about how like it basically says England was responsible for Ireland's potato famine in the 1850s.
Okay.
Which is actually pretty sick. And then once he gave me that, like a bunch of other people gave me their books to read. So now I have like 6 different books to read at the same time. Does that ever happen to you? Like people, like one person will give you a book and then another person gives you a book and then another book. And like you have all these books you're supposed to read. Like I feel guilty that I haven't finished at least one yet. So like I can't give them back to them just yet.
Yeah. I feel like I give myself the books though. Because I just like, I buy them, you know, because I'm at the store and like I'll see a book that catches my attention and it's like, fuck, I have to get it. Like, at some point, I have to get it.
Yeah.
Right now, I kind of stopped myself for a little bit because I already have, like, a bunch of books that I, again, like, I just have them on queue that I bought, but I haven't actually started because I'm reading all these other books. So, I have plenty of reading to do.
Yeah. Sure.
But it's a nice habit, dude. Like,
oh, yeah.
I don't even watch TV anymore. Like, I feel like I've also kind of became a little like boring sometimes because, or like just very ignorant to like pop culture and stuff like that. Like I hardly ever watch movies, you know.
Tumblr.
The only reason
I know anything about pop culture is because of Tumblr. Because like I see something about like Beyonce or like what happened at the Grammys.
Mm-hmm.
Like I didn't watch the Oscars, but I know what happened with like Moonlight being like.
Oh yeah.
I only know about that because of Tumblr. Like people are were reblogging about like, oh, did you see what happened?
I see it in like Twitter and stuff.
Yeah, like, I'm in the same way where. I think we've gotten into this conversation before where in the past few, at least for me, in the past few years of my life, I've become more of a creator versus a consumer. So whether it was through school and graphic design and just working on logos or whatever, and music becoming a bigger part of my life, that all takes away from TV time, from anything, watching YouTube or anything. And that includes like, in some sense, I still don't want to lose, but I used to like reading a lot. And I still do, but I just haven't picked up anything recently. But it takes time away from everything. So you do get out of the loop in a sense if you don't keep up with
it. I feel like you should limit yourself too, because like, you can get really caught up into reading, especially if you make it a habit and really enjoy it.
Well, I mean, what's wrong with reading?
Right.
That you stop doing.
Well, I mean...
You know what I mean? Like, at some point, you gotta put down the book and actually do some work. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, actually create something with that knowledge that you just gained from
reading. It's weird that reading is considered... It's still a form of entertainment, but it's more of a accepted form.
It distracts your mind, dude. Like, well, I was reading this book and, like, Albert Einstein and, like, the way that he thinks and stuff like that. And, He says reading is amazing, but, like, again, at some point, especially when you're older, like, it distracts your mind too much. And then you can get into the habit of, like, thinking all the time and, like, just being distracted, you know what I mean?
Versus
being in the moment.
Something else rather than you're, like, going
like,
forward.
Exactly. Uh-huh. Yeah. You're getting too distracted, like, with all this shit that you've been reading.
I can see that.
But at the same time, like... I mean, you probably have to read, like, excessively to get to that point.
Right.
You know, most people don't never reach that amount of reading.
See, but what if you get to a point where you're reading stuff, like, for example, we were reading James Baldwin and read a short story called Sonny's Blues, which is about these two brothers, and, like, one's, it's in, like, the slums of New York. And, like, these two brothers, this one brother went off and became a teacher, and, like, he's, like, taking care of himself. And this other one is just a blues musician who's, like, a drug addict, and he's kind of falling off the wagon a bunch. And so, like, it's this duality of these two guys. Like, one, it's kind of like, it's basically like an allegory for race relations in 1950s America.
Mm-hmm.
Like, almost post Jim Crow America. Like, how there was, like, this one idea of, like, I don't know if it was W.E.B. Du Bois or Du Bois, or if it was George Washington Carver, or what his name is. But anyway, there was, like, these two schools of thought. Like, one was, like, we can become better if we, like, self-empower ourselves. And there's another one, like, well, no, we have to wait for, you know, basically, it's like, send down your bucket, basically.
Right.
It was this idea, like, you know, that we would have to be helped out before we can help ourselves. And there's kind of, like, a duality, and it's, like, stuff like that you can take and you apply it to, like, today with, like, Black Lives Matter, like, all the race relations going on. So, like, what if somebody gets to a point where they read so much that they can apply it to real life, contemporary thinking, and then move forward from that.
Okay, so you're saying like learn and grow from where you're reading?
Well, that also plays
to that point,
the idea of history. Like, you can't know where you're going until you've seen where you come from.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. I see what you mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Coming to like a weird tangent, but related. So, you know how like in the South, the black culture came up. What is that? I forgot what it's called. The way they talk, how they use like the certain words. It's called something. I don't know how much you know about language, but like the kind of it's not a twang, cause it's a southern. The way this it's you know how like what's the when you speak Chinese, it's a different like it's not like just Chinese. They have like different
like different dialects.
Dialects. Okay, so it's something to do with the way the Africans in the South spoke with that certain dialect, cause it's like I don't want to make this a race thing, but the way they speak is like, how are you gonna like they
oh like
they,
like Creole like in Louisiana like
they the way okay so they'll a certain word will be like, I mean I'm trying to think of a specific word that they might use or, it's not like they it's like, you know. I would have to like look up like a southern like movie where like they spoke.
Just watch right now.
Well, anyways,
I feel like a pig in plow.
Yeah, something like that.
So like colloquialisms like that.
Something like that. You know, how, like they have that. It's like the African American. Like that's just what that's what they're tagged with in the South. How they kind of developed that other English version of them speaking. I forgot what it's called.
Metaphors that they have in like their slang.
Well, not
or
metaphor. It's almost like the slang, but it's just
the way they're
the way they pronounce their some of the words.
Their accents, dude.
Okay, it's accents, but they got those accents from the slave owners. A lot of those slave owners came from a specific part in England.
I see what you're trying to say now.
Oh, so you're saying
now
like,
I get it.
What I'm trying to say is that it's like a lot of okay. So a lot of people say like, why do those black people talk with that awful like the like slang and that you know that dialect or whatever? It's actually it comes from Europe and it comes from Ireland from those Ireland the farm like owners. That came from...
Oh, no way. Okay.
That came from, you know, Ireland or... I mean... British Columbia and, like, Ireland are, like, were at some point together, right? And they broke off. Or they're,
British
like...
Columbia.
England.
Like, well, yeah. The UK is just, like, it's the combination of Ireland, Scotland, and England. I don't remember when. I think it was like 1790s or something like that. It was like the Act of Union where they all became the United Kingdom. Because like, if you look at like the flags before then, like England's flag was just the red cross on a white text, whereas Scotland's was like that big X. And when you see the Union Jack, the blue and red one, where it's like the big cross with an X over it, it's like the combination of the two.
Oh, okay.
So like, but I kind of get what you're saying. So like, Ireland and... Like, if you talk to people in Ireland, they probably would fucking hate the British.
Yeah, okay. So what I'm saying is, like, back then when the first settlers came to, like, make, like, the tobacco farms... Anyways, a lot of those came from, like, I believe Ireland, which have those kind of... Speak in the same way that the, like, what is now considered to be, like, black southern dialect, which they got from their... slave owners, which came from Ireland. So really, that the way they speak is actually a traditional Ireland accent.
Oh, no way.
Yeah.
Okay.
If you trace it back, that's how they got their dialect, the way they speak. Like, come, like, you boy get, you know, like, I can't, like, I'm not even, I'm fumbling with the words, but.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I learned
like,
that.
I know what you're talking about, like.
I don't even want to say it because it's going to sound racist.
Right, you don't want it to sound stereotypical.
Yeah,
I get what
you
mean.
I can't even think of some of the words they would say, but, like, if you hear it,
there's
it would be
this video
pretty obvious.
Which basically, it's like a satire video. I think my sister showed me this a while, but it's like this animated video. It's like duck in, like, Louisiana, and it's, like, life in the bayou or something like that. It's,
yeah.
Let's see if I can't pull it up.
But it's just interesting because... How you're saying about history is, like, you can't move forward unless you know what happened in the past. Like, if people now knew the reason why the southern black people spoke in that kind of dialect in that certain way,
mm-hmm.
then they wouldn't make fun of it, because, you know, some of, I mean, Irish are white people in a sense.
Wait, here's, listen to this. So this is kind of like, it's just like super satire and like parodizing the oh, that's an ad. Sorry.
That's okay. You always get those first 5 seconds. Like, watch this video.
Oh, here we go.
I know that always happens.
But like, kind of like that.
Okay, yeah, something like that. Right? Yeah,
like that's sure. That's obviously not like
that's like accurate, exaggerating. Like,
yeah, totally.
But I mean, if you think about it, so do Southern white people speak like
right.
Some of them like speak like that. It's just they got that from this. Like, they didn't make that up by themselves. They had to like grab it from somewhere. So, I'm pretty sure it's not 100% like fully traditional what they spoke in Ireland. But I mean, that's where it comes from. So it's just interesting that you're, you know, that if you didn't know how we got here and you didn't understand it better, then you're gonna be constructing a future that is based on who knows what. If you didn't know what happened in the past, then you're gonna know that shit happens down the future if you don't implement, you know, certain things and laws or whatever. So,
like how most people, like, because we just legalized marijuana here in California, and people are saying like, well, this is like the end of prohibition. Like, are they equated legalizing marijuana, treating it like this criminalization of it? Is kind of like prohibition. Like, it creates more problems than it was worth.
Yeah.
Because, like, you know, when it's on the black market, there's no way of regulating it, so you don't know if it's in it, if it's safe or whatnot, and, like, I don't know. So kind of.
I mean, like medical marijuana has been going on for a while, though.
Right.
Like almost a decade.
But even then, that gets shut down by the federal government a bunch.
There was a time, like, a period of time where it was in a very, like, gray area in the law, like... Like, federally, of course, it's not legal, but then it is, like, legal medicinal, but then some, like, dispos would get in trouble and stuff like that, and, like, they would get raided and stuff, especially because a lot of them would sell without, like, an actual, like...
Permit or anything.
Like, a medical card.
Yeah.
And a lot of dispos do, like, especially now that it's legal, like, a lot of dispos are already being cool with just having people in, especially if they know them. Because technically, like, it's legal to have it if you just happen to, like, if you get it gifted, I guess. But there's like, nowhere where you can actually go and buy it, like, recreationally, because that doesn't exist yet.
They
need to get licenses, and that takes a while.
You can just walk in, because it's recreational.
It got passed, but, like, it doesn't go into effect until next year.
Like, no, like, it is, no, it went into effect immediately, actually.
Oh, it did?
But, like I said...
Oh, no, right, the businesses.
Yeah, the businesses. Sure. There's no businesses that have licenses to sell it recreationally. Everything that exists right now is just medicinal. And, like, for a medicinal weed, you need a recommendation from a doctor, a.k.a. a medical card.
So you
can't just walk into a dispo and, like, say, like, oh, so wait, yeah, I thought it's legal.
You need a separate...
not forever.
Permit to sell recreationally.
Yeah, but only till like next year, pretty much.
Right. What was the limit? It's like you can have a certain amount on your person up to
a,
like,
shit
certain,
ton, dude. Like a shit ton. Like,
yeah,
like 3 ounces. There's like 3 or 4.
That's a lot to hold on. Like, just on yourself.
Yeah.
3 ounces.
That's like, bro. Let's walk get blazed.
Yeah. Walking down the street with the tree, like, is that 3 ounces? Like,
Yeah. Yeah, and like, but. It's like now that it's legal, like a lot of like cops are very chill about it. Like if they catch you smoking, then they're mostly gonna tell you to just not do it outside. Like, go, like, leave, or, like, you know.
Yeah.
If they're in a bad mood, they could give you a ticket. But still, like, smoking in public is against the law.
Well, that's kind of like drinking in public, I guess.
Of course,
that's such an arbitrary rule. So I feel like as a cop, like, if you had to enforce the law, you want to go catch people who are, like, the rapists and the murderers.
Of course.
Like,
yeah.
So you don't want to, like, a kid who's smoking.
You don't
want to
waste,
like,
your time.
Right.
With
you
don't want
to be the dick cop who comes in, like,
exactly.
Oh, stop having fun. Like,
exactly.
Come on, dude.
Exactly. Like, there's so much other shit to worry about. Like, that's like, minuscule. Like, it's irrelevant for a lot of cops. Although, yeah, there are some cops that want to be dicks. They're just in a bad mood.
Right.
I guess. But... Yeah, it's cool, dude. Like, it's pretty cool that it's like people are, like, slowly, like, opening up their consciousness towards, like, try to understand how these substances can actually help you, you know?
I was watching the news the other day. It had, like, this panel. It was this one guy who's, like, a business owner who's going to be owning, like, a recreational place down in San Diego. And then
cool.
He had the mayor of Poway.
Okay.
Because, like, I guess Poway is its own city, and it's, like, it's a whole thing. But they were talking about, just that, like, how they legalized it in California... And what it's going to mean for San Diego specifically. So, like, the business owner is saying stuff like, oh, well, you know, there's a 5% tax on top of what the state's already taxing us. But then the mayor of Poway is saying something like, yeah, Poway, we're not going to take part in this. Like, they opted to not be part of the legalization process or something like
they
that.
Have
like,
to, really.
I don't know. Like,
they
it's technically
don't have
like,
to?
They were. I forget what he said specifically, but it was something to the effect of like, we're not gonna be as tolerant at just because it's legal now.
Yeah.
Oh, and what his reasoning was like, we're gonna keep Poway. You know, Poway is one of the safest places. We don't do that here. But at the same time, like, Poway is one of the worst places in San Diego because of Oxy. Like, there's so many designer
That's
drugs
crazy.
Out in Poway. It's ridiculous.
Damn.
So I was kind of cracking myself up. Like, you're worried about pot, which like. How many people have you heard that have, like, overdosed on pot? So, like,
pot, it's funny because I had a stigma against it growing up. And
I think everyone did. When you're young, your parents were very open-minded
was,
like that.
It's the gateway drug.
Yeah, through high school.
It's dumb. Like,
actually, for school, I did a little it was a graphic design project, but it was pretty free-handed on what media you could use. So I used film and music because... I mean, I'm not any kind of cinematographer, but anyways, I was doing mine based off of how weed was used. So, let's see, that's kind of a long history. Basically, in like the 1940s or 50s, probably earlier than that, they found out that hemp... Okay, so there was, like, a paper company that was making paper the traditional route, and then a hemp company that made it more efficient to make paper because it was stronger. And so one side basically made hemp look bad, and so the way they threw hemp underneath the bus was by basically using, like, black, like, Mexicans as the scapegoat for, like, oh, these people are using the drugs, they're rapists and stuff. So that became a huge propaganda thing in the United States.
That's why they started calling it, like, marijuana.
Yeah, because marijuana was actually a Mexican term for a tobacco leaf.
Uh-huh.
Marijuana was never, if you went back then, if you said marijuana down to Mexico, it would hand you a certain tobacco leaf. It was never actually pot. But they tagged that marijuana onto pot, and then a lot of weed people were like, oh yeah, pot's bad, and then that's how kind of it went downhill.
It's crazy.
Like, that's
dude,
how it
like
got
the
that
medium
bad.
Controls.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, but that seems more like a PR campaign than anything else. Like,
no, that's what it was, because they wanted they didn't want hemp to like outdo the paper.
See, but then,
business.
Now they're doing research on like LSD, like MDMA, to help people with like diseases and stuff like that.
I mean, yeah,
they're using MDMA to treat like PTSD and
right.
stuff like that.
Like vets who come back and like
exactly, and it's actually been proven to be very effective.
Oh.
Like they've been testing like ketamine for fucking like depression. Like ketamine, that's a disassociative. Like it must be I've never done that shit. Like it must be like a weird trip.
Wait, it's disassociative. What do you mean by that? Like
it means that you don't really feel like you're in your body.
That makes sense.
You're,
like
kind of watching a movie, like, a third person.
I guess it kind of makes sense, because, like, with depression, like, you're kind of, like, trapped in yourself.
Exactly.
So maybe being able to get out of that.
If you get out of your ego for a little bit. That's the same thing with, like, psychedelics. Like, psychedelics can be very disassociative, meaning you, like, again, you leave your body and you have a more objective perspective of the world, of yourself. You know, you're not seeing life through this filter that we call our emotions, or this subjective filter that we have, right? Or biases, whatever, cognitive biases, whatever you want to call it. So it can be very, very, can make you appreciate life. Like, shrooms can make you appreciate life, can kill your depression. But at the same time, if you have certain demons inside of you, it can be very, like, super scary. Like, it can do the opposite. It could leave you to a place where you need, like, therapy to get through that, you know?
So would in that case, would stimulants, do you think, would that be worse? Because like
stimulants,
that just like amplifies whatever's going on.
Stimulants are different because stimulants or psychedelics are not the same drug. Like you can't compare like alcohol to like LSD or like cocaine to LSD, because they don't produce the same effects. Like stimulants just give you energy. Like yeah, some of them can be like, for example, like something crazy like meth. Like that's both a stimulant and a psychedelic. So imagine like what's gonna happen.
Uh-huh.
You're gonna be fucking tripping balls, and at the same time you're gonna have like so much fucking like
crap.
You're not gonna be able to control that energy. That's why like you fucking see tweakers like moving and doing weird shit, because they can't control that energy.
Do you know about that guy in Florida? It was like 2 years ago. He was on like bath salts or something, and he like ate somebody's face.
Yeah, I heard about it.
And so everyone's like, it's the zombie apocalypse, guys.
I know, there's so many fucking crazy ass substances, dude. There's like this, apparently there's this like not psychedelic, but instead of like giving you visuals, it gives you like auditory hallucinations.
Oh god!
Isn't that fucking wait, so scary? That and it lasts for like a week.
That's like
oh god!
It's
like
it's
like I
want to
go. Yeah, exactly. So I was like, I want to go schizoid for like a bit. Like what the fuck?
Like you kick back one day, like you know what sounds like fun right now? Being schizo.
I don't know about that. What is that? Is that
schizophrenic?
Yeah.
It's like
I've heard of it.
Oh really? You don't know?
I don't know what it is.
It's a disease where you hear voices.
It's actually really terrifying.
It's very scary. It's a very scary thing. I actually had an uncle that he has still.
So it's literally you function normally. You just hear like all of a sudden.
No, and
it's
well,
actually
it's
super debilitating
exactly.
In some cases.
Exactly.
Like, but like because you hear these things, like it you can't turn them off. It's like a bunch of different voices whispering in your head, like you're not worth anything. Or,
exactly.
Like,
imagine like you're okay. Everyone has that inner voice, right? Like that, you know, your thought process.
Second, yeah, you're.
But
like,
imagine having that, but instead of you hearing it in here, you hear it from like over there.
Uh-huh.
And it's like I'm talking to you right now. It's like you're looking that way, and I'm talking to you, and you're hearing my voice.
And it's
but there's
the
no one here.
It doesn't go away.
Exactly.
And they can tell you horrible things like you should kill yourself, or you're worthless.
You're nestled. Exactly.
So many mental.
Can get to a point where you even have visual hallucinations. You know, because you're just in another place.
Oh, wow.
And the trippy part is that. Like schizophrenics, they don't know, like for the most part, if they're barely like getting diagnosed, they don't know what they're that's like one of the cases or like one of the main symptoms about schizophrenia, that they are I guess they're like unaware that they're like in that state of psychosis, if that makes sense. Of course with like therapy they probably get to a better place, and you know I feel like it depends on I guess your level of psychosis, you know.
Right. But would that be a symptom of your disease, or is that more of your perspective of what reality is? Because like if you grew up and like that's something that's been there all the time, and you kind of don't think of anything of it until you get to a point where like other people talk about it. Like
mm-hmm.
unless you know
mm-hmm.
somebody else's experience where they don't
yeah,
have
right.
that going on, how would you ever know that that's a problem?
Well, schizophrenia doesn't really develop until it can develop like when you're younger, but it's very rare. It usually develops around our age, actually, like
mm-hmm.
early 20s, mid 20s.
Yeah.
If they say if you're able to get past like your mid 20s and you're just free from schizophrenia, like it's not gonna happen. But yeah, it's I don't think it's very common. Like there are certain like early symptoms about it, I guess, that you could. But they're very vague, you know? There's, like, depression and stuff like that. And, like,
yeah.
a lot of people suffer from that. They're not necessarily, like, psychotic or anything. No.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I don't know. Yeah, it's a scary disease, dude. Like, there's some videos on YouTube where it's, like, a simulation type of thing, dude. If you watch
yeah.
it with, like, headphones,
there
that's
is?
Just terrifying, dude.
It's
terrifying,
I couldn't
dude.
Get through it.
It's, like, a
first-person
thing, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my God.
It's very terrifying. It's, like, people calling you names and just, yeah.
And it's, like, you have the, it's, like, somebody just... You see Tyler walking around and you don't know, but you could be like going through that at any moment. Is that kind of how
wait,
it is?
What do you mean?
Like you don't I mean
yeah, it's all
it's
internal.
Like you don't know if people are dealing with it.
If,
in a sense
oh,
because
no
they're
sense. Well,
they're trying
like
to live a
like
normal
if,
life.
You're
it's
stuck
like if
in
you
your
just
world.
Met somebody yeah. right away, you know, could you tell if they were depressed or not? Like
yeah, that's what I'm saying. So it's kinda like
it's more of an internal
yeah, it's an internal thing. Yeah, you can't.
It's
you're
not like
trying
where
to
if someone has a cold and it's like, you know, they got the snot running down their face
yeah,
and they look drained. Like
that's
it won't
a physical,
be the
like element then.
Yeah.
Versus
yeah, exactly. Like there are a lot of people who have schizophrenia, but it's not as like debilitating, and they're able to like thanks to therapy and like
mm-hmm.
you know antipsychotic medicine, they're able to live a somewhat normal life. I guess.
How is that triggered though? Is it triggered through having some? Like,
yeah, I think it's
traumatic.
It's like your genetics. It's like genetics. Like
you can live a happy. Life and all of a sudden development.
Well, no, it's there's also like environmental factors.
Okay, so
like,
it's
if,
okay.
imagine like if you're raised like if your childhood was shit and you were abused and you went through so much fucking shit that you're not gonna want to be part of your external world. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna create your own world inside of here, and that's when you start kind of
okay.
developing these kind of like weird psychotic symptoms. That's
so,
what I think.
So like if you're a kid who's like you've got childhood depression. Or, like, you've been through something traumatic,
through
like,
shit,
you'd be
yeah.
more susceptible to it.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Definitely.
Okay.
So,
I guess that's true, because I don't really, like, of all the cases I've read about it, I haven't really read it that many from, you know, people who are a little bit more privileged or live in a more comfortable setting.
Mm-hmm. It can still happen, though. Like,
right.
You really don't, like, the scary part about it is that there's also a lot of cases where it's just regular people who live a normal childhood, you know, a happy life, never really have much to struggle with, and then they just happen to start hearing voices one night. And that's scary.
Yeah, I've never gone through that.
That's
it's funny because I talk to Alex a lot, and he's like, he tells me about going through, I mean, he does more experimental drugs than I do. even if it's just marijuana. I've smoked twice, and
I don't think the first time
I really I considered myself smoking, I took like one pretty decent hit, and that's it. You know what I mean? And that's my extent.
Did you feel anything?
Yeah, I mean, I went through. I feel more of physical changes than anything. Mm-hmm. Like, I got twitchy, like.
Yeah.
Muscles I didn't even know could twitch were starting to twitch on my body. That's anyways, he goes, like, he was talking about, because I've had it once, like, two or three times, sleep paralysis.
Oh, yeah.
And the extent of my sleep paralysis is literally opening up my eyes and, like, I realize that I can't move and I panic and I can't breathe. That's the extent. But
yeah.
Have you ever, like, gone through that or heard noises or
there
seen
was,
things?
There was a time where I was like, I'm going to try lucid dreaming.
I tried to
get to that point where like you try the method of like, okay, now you got to tell yourself that you're awake, but you're going to allow yourself to fall asleep. So I tried doing that, that's like psyching myself out, and I actually got to this point where like I knew I was asleep, but I was like
you were aware.
Mentally there, like I was in the moment, and like I couldn't move, and I thought there was somebody in my room. Because
yeah,
I was having night terrors or something like that.
It makes you feel like there's a presence in the room sometimes.
It wasn't like weird voices. It wasn't anything
yeah.
like, oh, it's my grandma in my room. So kind of checking up on me. Yeah. It was like it, this foreboding, like, terrible, like, demon kind of thing.
Exactly.
And you couldn't do anything because you couldn't move. I was like,
yeah,
this is the worst.
Scary.
So I never tried anything like that.
You have to be able to get through that, though.
Did
like,
you, so that
you
only happened to you ever once in your life?
I think once, yeah.
It's happened to me like three or four times, like, but like I would literally just wake up and like whatever position I was in bed, realize that like I'm awake but my body couldn't physically move.
Yeah.
And but I've never so you said you heard like noises or saw things or
I
you felt
really,
a presence.
I couldn't explicitly see
anything?
Like somebody there,
yeah,
but it felt like
shadows.
Yeah, exactly. It felt like there was just something
okay.
there.
Yeah. No, I've actually heard stuff, dude. It's
yeah,
weird.
I've never gotten that far.
There's been periods in my life where, like, I have sleep paralysis, like, on the regular, like, every night.
Yeah, he tells me that. I
so
freak
it's,
out.
It's kind of like, I mean, after a while, you kind of know, because you're able to identify when you're in it. Just
uh-huh.
to the fact that you're aware, you're able, you remember, it's like, okay, like, I know this feels like shit, but, like, it's going to be over in, like, a minute or two. Just
uh-huh.
let yourself calm down, like, it's going to be okay. And then you wake. But, like, when I was younger, I used to lucid dream a lot. So, like, yeah, I remember, like, I would literally just, like, pass out, like, on the couch, and I would enter a state of sleep paralysis. Like, I could literally see everything, dude. It's crazy. Like, because I would fall asleep, say, with the lights on, and I would still go into a state of sleep paralysis, and I could see my room, dude. I could see my arm just like this, but I can't move.
Uh-huh.
It's just like, damn. It's scary, but, like, after a while, you do get kind of used to it. And lucid dreaming is very interesting.
Uh-huh.
It's an interesting concept, but it can also be kind of scary because your mind can, like, or at least your subconscious mind can put, like, some very, like, trippy images. And if you don't have, like, a... If you're not, like, stable mentally, then it can be kind of, like, nerve-wracking. Like, I've seen, like...
Sure.
I remember one time, like, I was trying to, like, lucid dream, and I remember I saw, like, a face of Jesus with, like, bloody eyes. And I was like, holy fuck. Like, that
what?
Terrified
right.
me. That terrified the fuck out of me. Like, I have to make myself wake up. Yeah, I don't
that's
know.
That's a trip.
I know. And I was very young, too. I was like, oh, shit, that's scary. Yeah.
I think I've only, like, actually accomplished a lucid dream, like, once.
Okay.
And it was something low-key. Like, I was in a classroom, and then it was just like, oh, wait, I'm dreaming.
Yeah.
So I can do whatever I want.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, like, I forget what I did. I like, made fun of the teacher or something like that. And I'm like, or I did something crazy. Like, I made myself a superhero and I went flying or something like that.
Yeah.
But, like, it's never been anything like, you know, night terrors or anything like that.
No, yeah. For me, it's both, like, when I used to do it a lot, like, I would lucid dream. And some of the things that I would experience would be beautiful, dude. Like, after you do it for a while, you do get kind of better at, like, I guess, like, controlling it, you know? And I remember I perfectly remember, like, having this lucid dream where, like, it's like I fell asleep on the bed, and then in my dream, it's like I woke up, and I'm, like, in the same room, and everything's the same, but I'm in a dream. I'm, like, in another dimension of the same existence
like
that I'm at.
Like
it's crazy, but I'm aware of it. I'm like, oh, shit, I'm in a dream. I just fell asleep right here. Like, literally, this is the same room where I'm in,
it's
like...
It's just a different world.
It's just a different dimension,
so
dude.
So, like, a false wake?
Yeah, that's actually happened to me a lot of times.
Of
a lot of times, I don't realize that I'm doing it, and then I wake up, and it's like, what? I did this already. Or other times, they turn into lucid dreams, and then it's like, oh, shit, like, I'm dreaming. You know, there's a lot of techniques. They say if you look at your hand, stuff like that. Because if you make the habit of looking at your hand, like, on your normal...
I think you told
whatever
me about
this reality is, right?
Yeah.
Then you'll start doing that when you're dreaming, and then when you dream, your hand is usually like distorted, or like you look like from like different colors.
I heard it's either hands or you look at a clock.
At a clock, yeah, exactly. Yeah. If you look at a clock and then you turn around and then you look at it again, if you're in a dream, it's gonna be like a different time every time you look.
Oh
at
my
it.
God.
But obviously, like in this reality, whatever this reality is, and it's gonna be the same. And that's gonna kind of if you make the habit of that, you'll will be doing it, and you like for sure you will be doing it in your dreams. Yeah. And that's how you start lucid dreaming. And it's very cool, dude. Like once you get past those scary moments and you're able to see the bigger picture, of like accessing your subconscious mind like that, it's kind of trippy, dude. Like it's very like whoa, like. If this exists, then what is this fucking reality? What's the difference between this, like us being awake or whatever, if we're even awake right now, or being asleep and being in that state?
What if everything is that we're perceiving as reality is just another dream within another
within the same dream?
Right. But then how does I wonder how
the multiverse.
It's a multiverse. That would actually be an interesting thing if that was a multiverse like that. That's how it works. But then like. If that's lucid dreaming, then how does astral projection
come into it? That's, I've never astral projected, but I read a lot about it and I watch videos about it. You have to get yourself to a state of, like, very meditative state. I meditate almost every day. So, like, I've never been able to do that, but sometimes I feel like, I don't know, there was this one time that I was meditating, dude, and, like, I literally felt like my consciousness, I don't know, like, this awareness that I had that we have right now past our ego, I kind of feel like I was being like levitated. It was weird, dude. Like I feel like I was kind of detaching myself from my body just from meditating, which is a trip.
Yeah.
And I feel like if you're able to do that, then that's what they call astral projection. That's when you're able to kind of get yourself in a state of like ego death in a way, but not to the point where you reach enlightenment and stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
It's kind of like a step towards enlightenment, and you get to a place where you see a lot of colors and stuff like that. It's just weird. You know, it's like you're exploring the depths of your subconscious mind naturally, because you can also do this with like drugs, with like psychedelics. That's what psychedelics do to you. You know, as people who meditate, yeah, you could spend like 30 years meditating, like fucking like mastering the craft of meditation and Zen Buddhism and all that shit, right? Or you could take a fucking like an LSD tab and then reach that state of enlightenment in the night. And reach those states of consciousness and realize have all these fucking epiphanies in one night instead of like 30 years.
See, but I wonder if it would be like, it would be a more fulfilling enlightenment if you did it naturally.
Exactly.
As opposed to...
No, you're right. You're right. They say that the only reason why doing it naturally is better is because since this I guess this practice is so like, it's such a big part of your life now. Like it's been so long that those changes that it made in your brain, cause these are, dude, when you start like meditating and you start exploring your consciousness like that, dude, it makes like physical changes in your brain. Dude, like some parts in your brain start like working differently and they connect to each other differently. They've done studies on this. Dude. Like they put, I've been reading this book on enlightenment, and they especially got a book about like a bunch of studies that they've done where they put like, you know, what it's called, like, fMRI scanners on the heads of, like, monks and people who meditate and stuff like that. And they're able to see, like, as they move through the different levels of, I guess, meditation and doing stuff like that, they see changes in their brain, dude. It's a trip, dude. Like, some
that's
parts...
so cool.
Like, I forgot if it was, like, the pre... I forgot the name.
Prefrontal cortex?
I think, like, the this part of your brain... Right?
I think that's what it is. The frontal cortex.
Which is, like, something about it, like, some part about it is associated with, like, your individuality. So, say that I'm me, and you are, you know, Tyler and Adam over
like
here.
Like, monkeys could kind of be that, right?
No, what happens...
Like they see themselves in the mirror.
Uh-huh. Exactly. Now, what happens if you decrease the activity in that? Then you're gonna feel like you're just one, and the universe around you is just one thing. You're
whoa,
united with everything.
Okay. That's how animals
isn't
are,
that
right?
A trip?
Animals don't think that they're a person. You know, they don't think they just think they go out in the wild. They die from getting eaten. That's just the circle. You know what I mean?
I think
right.
In a way,
pain,
putting yourself in.
I don't know if they feel emotion about it. You know.
Yeah, it's a trip, dude.
Like oh no, my grandma died. She got eaten by a snake.
No, I mean, animals are just pure awareness.
Yeah,
but
that's true.
We're also this, like, if you're able to get past your ego, then I feel like you reach kind of like a state like that of just pure awareness.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning there's no emotion attached to what you're experiencing. There's no subjectiveness. It's just objectiveness. You're just
being
separated
you
from...
You just take it as it is.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, you're just looking at it, but you're not making opinions or putting your ego in it. You're just observing. You're just being...
See, I wonder...
imagine, like, reaching
like,
the state
maybe
of...
Maybe that's individuality. Like, when you see something and you react to it, Maybe that's like that's your own individuality.
Maybe,
so like,
yeah.
Because like, I don't know. That'd be a like I couldn't imagine like seeing, like if they had a news report like some 30 kids got blown up in it like a school today, and I couldn't imagine just being like, oh, that's and just taking that as is and just knowing and not reacting
instead of being like, damn, that sucks.
Yeah,
like, poor like their family, they must be suffering, right?
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. You just see it as like, oh. Like
that's
such
a trip.
Yeah, I mean, because if you think about it, how many ideas, like just in your regular day, how many ideas are being brought to your head? How much stimuli, like just driving, whatever, like driving to school or work, whatever. You know, you see advertisement, you're hearing the radio, on the music, the lyrics of the songs, but they're fitting you with all this fucking information, dude. It's kind of like getting yourself away from that. Like, I feel like a lot of the ideas or like emotions that you get in your, or like thoughts that you get in your head are not necessarily coming from you. They're coming from all this external stimuli that you're getting every day, like all this information that you don't necessarily need. So like, it's beautiful because like we have the ability to reject that information. You know, it's, I don't think our thoughts and like our emotions make us, it's just like our reaction to those thoughts and emotions, you know?
But like, it's a prescribed reaction, like it's how you think you should react, not how you
exactly how
react.
You were programmed to react to it, how you were socially am I talking too loud?
No, I'm just really far away from the mic.
Oh, for sure. It's weird because me and Tyler are like chilling, like hanging
I'm
back
like way back here, and
I'm
you're
like,
just
like, and then,
okay,
and then
yeah,
Alex
sure.
is like really professional, has his like arms crossed at the table, you know. And we just have this one mic, and it's like our chairs are all different. We don't have the production quality of like a nice studio where everybody's equally away from their own, or we don't even have their own mics. Anyways,
yeah. But yeah, that like that whole topic of like spirituality and all that stuff, it was very interesting, dude. Like,
see, but I wonder how many religions, like organized religions, strive towards that in some form. Like if that singularity is what they meant as like nirvana or heaven or even
meeting
just,
God. You
yeah.
Because like, yeah, well, it's just, it's a different way of looking at it, dude. Like, for example, even just the word God means something different from different religions, right? Obviously for like Christian and like Catholics is like God, like they see it as this other like being, right? This
mm-hmm.
universal like entity that created you in a way. And there's like for example, Hinduism talks about like more, not necessarily that you are God, but like that you, in a way that this universe is actually all in your head, in a way. You know what I mean? And it's
like the physical properties of the way you live, your physical form is a universe.
Hold that thought.
Yeah, you could argue that everything that's happening
right
now.
Here, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's right there.
Yeah.
You could argue that everything that's happening right now is all in our heads, dude, because it's just information that's being transmitted to our heads.
Yeah,
you know
so
what I mean?
Know
so they,
this
it's,
is...
Exactly. I mean, we think this is real because this is what we've always known as real, but again, it's just like a dream. Like, how do you know if that's not real?
So
I always I know, I was getting to shit like this.
No, well, the thing about dream, like how you said you could, what is it called? Dream where you control it?
Lucid dream?
Lucid dream. You said you've done that before?
Oh yeah, plenty of times.
So the whole thing with me is like, why am I not trying to lucid dream right now? Because I know that this is reality. Well, when I dream, I think that's reality. There's no difference
between
I dream and when I'm awake, because I don't know the difference. When I'm asleep, when I'm dreaming, I don't know the difference until I wake up. I'm like, damn it, that was a good dream. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's true.
So like, I never know even if I should be trying to lucid dream right now, because what if this is a dream right now? Like, I'm not thinking that when I'm dreaming. So how do you even like, you already said like, if you get in the habit of looking at clocks in your hands.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're dreaming is so in your daily life, in real life, do you catch yourself looking at your hand or at a clock or?
Well, I don't really lucid dream anymore now.
Oh, okay.
It's because I smoke weed and.
Oh yeah, you already told me you get like
weed,
bad.
Weed does it does mess you out. It doesn't let you dream that much, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Because it messes with your REM sleep cycle.
Yeah. Okay. You've,
so
you've
you don't.
Like
yeah. So you, I mean, you still dream. You just don't remember them.
Right.
You know? So, I don't really dream that much anymore, but it's whatever. Like I already experimented with that stuff, and I mean I'm not gonna say I never dream. Of course I dream every once in a while, but
dreaming it puts you in a whole different reality. It puts you in a world that you've never, like, that never happened, but it all of a sudden happens.
So you being in a psychedelic like trip, you know, like you're somewhere else. You know?
Yeah.
And you're in your bubble, or like, fuck, like, or like smoking DMT. Like, imagine that. That must be scary. It's like you're killing yourself. It's like you committed suicide in a way. Your consciousness, mentally, subjectively, you're killing yourself. Your consciousness is separating from your body. You're going to another dimension. So this reality, as you know, it stops. You don't even remember this reality because you go through different.
I heard DMT trips. You go through like a lifetime.
Yeah, new experiences.
Within 10 or 20 minutes, you literally live another life.
Yeah, multiple lives. Multiple. Through different consciousnesses.
When you take DMT.
Okay, so wait.
We're talking about DMT.
I know we're going. We're like
first. See, first
of all, we go on tangents, man.
First of all, back up. What's DMT? First of all,
I've never heard of that. Really? DMT
is
dimethyltryptamine. And it's a natural occurring substance that's found in like many plants in the world. Like, it's a natural thing. Like,
even in
some trees out here probably contain some kind of DMT. They think that it's produced in the human brain, although it's never been proven.
Cuz
it's been proven that rats produce it in their brains, but they've never been able to prove it in the brains
but
of humans.
They know that it's released when you're at death.
When you die.
They don't know that?
Yeah, no, it's just a myth.
That when you die, you go, though, they don't know if you go through that?
It's never been proven. Like, it's been hypothesized. Like, it's something that, it sounds likely because, again, when you smoke DMT, it's kind of like you kill yourself, you kill your ego.
But I've heard something like that, where, like, because you're saying DMT is, like, where you can, like, live another lifetime within your own, right?
Like, it's
mentally. You're not going to know that that's your own lifetime, that you're still this person.
What I read somewhere, like, suggesting that, like, when you die, your idea of eternity is because in that last couple of seconds before you really go away, like, your perception of time is expanded. So, like, 1 second could feel like a million years.
Exactly. If you smoke DMT, you only trip for 5 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes, and you feel like it was a lifetime.
You know, I wonder if they got the idea of when you see flashbacks and you see your whole life flashing before your eyes. I wonder if that's where they got it from. Where you're kind of seeing a lifetime presented in you where you felt like you lived it again, but it was only a few seconds. Anyways,
I think what happens is that when you die, I feel like you kind of have, in a way, your ego leaves. And then you kind of observe your world in like a third-person perspective.
And then you
for
die
a little bit.
Your
and
body.
Then and then the cycle repeats, and you're, I don't know. I mean, if you believe that you reincarnate into another person, then that's, you know, your belief. At that point, there's no way to prove it. I personally believe that it makes sense for your consciousness to go somewhere. Like, if we were, like, before we were born, like, do you guys remember anything before you were born? No, right? Like, how is that different than when you die? Are you guys going to remember anything? What happened when you were nothing, before you were born? What happened? Well, then something came, right? Which is life as we know it. Then what's going to happen when you go back to being the nothing? Well, I mean, if everything in life has another side of the coin, if everything about life is duality, like the yin-yang and all that shit, then it makes sense that when you die, you go back to being nothing, then that will bring something.
But
that's my perspective.
In, like, elementary physics, they tell us, like, one of the rules of, like, energy is, like, energy, there's, like, mass or energy, but I think it was energy, too, but, like, energy cannot be created or destroyed. Like, there's always an equal balance, like, it's like a zero sum.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I guess it makes sense, like, in order for there to be life, one, like, you don't just get a new one and the other one goes away. It's like that one gets reassigned to something else.
You get, like, you become a cockroach, you're like, fuck!
Right.
You're like, I wanted to be an eagle. Man, if I were being incarnated, kind of, like, if my second choice besides being another human, even though that's kind of, like, you could be fucking born in another country where you have, like, you're running away from fucking missiles and I don't know. I'm just saying it could be worse than being, like, a cool bird or something. But anyways, if it wasn't, like, something kind of cool in a first world country, it'd probably be, like, a bird or something, being able to fly and, like.
What if we, like, all right now, we were in a simulation, like, in a virtual reality? All
right, but.
Okay.
How would you know that we're not?
Okay. So this is where the Matrix things comes in. Like, how do we not know we're not, like, simulating?
Well,
if a dream is the same thing as, oh, I thought that was real, and we unplugged and we become our true selves when we wake up. What's the extension of that if we unplug and it becomes like the fucking movie?
And also think about like cognitive biases, like the way that you look at it, the world is completely, like I said, it has to go through this filter that you've created, which is your subjective mind, the way that you were programmed when you were growing up, where you were socially, what's the word? I guess socially programmed in a way, right?
Yeah.
Like, if you take that into perspective, then how are you so sure that what you're looking at is actually what you're looking at? Even Albert Einstein said that reality is just an illusion, merely a persistent one. That's what he said.
Yeah. Wow, interesting.
But, and like, it's fucking Albert Einstein. Like, this guy that was able to, like, completely defy what the laws of physics were back then.
Right.
And he said that this is not how it works. Like, these laws that people took for granted.
Yeah.
It's like if right now, like, someone came to us and told us, like, the world is not, you know, an oval or whatever, right? It's more like a fucking square. We'd be like, what the fuck? And then he actually proved it. We're like, what? Like, it would defy everything that we understand about reality, right?
Yeah.
So that's kind of, that's, yeah, like, it's just the fact that he says that, and uh-huh. that means that he was able to see past, like, the ego, this,
yeah,
this like, role of a little person that we created, yeah. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Yeah. We were just, like, souls playing roles, pretty much.
We're just, sounds yeah. like a really cool band name, Souls Playing Roles.
Kind of sounds like an album name, you know what I'm
saying? Yeah, Souls Playing Roles.
Or, like, a song, I don't know.
Like a death metal band.
We joke about that all the time.
But yeah, it's interesting though. But dude, like, going back to the same question, the DMT.
So what is it? So you've never heard of it?
Yeah, no.
Yeah. So you can get it like where do they
you can extract
refine it from?
You can extract from plants. Like there's a lot of different type of like bushes, like trees that contain DMT. You have to
so
make
it's like
go through a certain process.
Is it a pill?
You smoke it. Well, you vape it. You can't smoke it. If you smoke it and you're burning it, you're not getting actual DMT in your body. You're just gonna fucking cough
so what's
it up.
Oh, it's like crystals though, right?
It's like a crystal, yeah. It's like a, is there like crystal or like kind of powderish type? Just like, what'd you think of a like a drug looks like pretty much?
Yeah, like in a bag form. And then you go through
it's like the stereotypical drug, but like
yeah, but it's
and
not
they say,
it's not like fucking meth or anything. Like it's
right.
a psychedelic that takes you like to so many.
They say a lot of things you see are like geometric shapes and patterns.
Yeah, you go through like a cool fucking kaleidoscope.
Have you ever seen any of you have just recently seen the movie Doctor Strange?
Yeah,
you know that when he goes into that in the beginning, kind of when that Buddhist lady kind of puts him through the first time he goes through like the other dimension.
Mm-hmm.
I mean that's an artistic. Take on it, but it's probably similar to that where you're seeing like different going through different spaces and time, you know what I mean, different.
See, that would trip me up if I saw like a bunch of different planes intersecting
yeah,
once.
Like
I wouldn't want to just sit still. I'd probably freak out.
No,
well,
yeah.
DMT, you pass out. Like you.
Oh,
smoke.
So you're unconscious for the whole
thing. You're unconscious.
Oh, I thought it was more like. Okay.
I mean, you'll be like, oh shit,
right.
oh shit, and then if,
yeah, but
you'll
be
break through. If you break through, dude, like do you. Because it depends on the dose. Like, if you only do a little bit, you're probably just going to see, like, you're going to... They say that you hear this, like, ringing, like, beep, like that.
Which is kind of scary.
And, like, and you start seeing, like, I mean, colors and, like, geometric figures.
That's what I'm saying.
Like,
if you...
But,
I've never done it, but I can imagine...
I've never done it myself, no. But I watch a lot of videos on that shit, dude. Because it's very interesting. It's something that I find, like, very, like... I feel like... I guess... what's the right word? Like...
Intriguing.
The fuck.
Complexity.
The complexity and the how influential and like how like meaningful or like depth this experiences can be. Like they're so appealing that it's like it's so much like you have to like kind of I don't know, you have to look into it. It's interesting. You know what I mean? Uh-huh. Like it's so compelling to not consider it like something that could be I don't know, like a key to another dimension, like a key to like what this reality really is, which is just pure consciousness, right? But yeah, it's fucking crazy. But like I was saying, it really depends on the dose too. Like some people are very sensitive. They'll break through. Breakthrough is that's what they call when you completely like go past your ego. You go to DMT land somewhere else. Right? You completely forget about this existence. You go through different existences, if that makes sense.
So kind of when they say you're living another life.
That's what they call
which
breaking
is,
through.
Which
but
is
that's
scary
just,
because
right.
you can feel like you're trapped in this life cycle.
You'll see.
I know.
When I was like 6, I had these really bad fevers and I would hallucinate because of it.
Damn, that's crazy.
So it was like super bad. I can't believe my mom didn't take me to the hospital. But
when you're physically sick from a fever,
physically sick from a fever. Like,
isn't that called like fever dreams or something?
I think it was a fever dream. Because like, but I was sick, so like it was terrifying. Like I was just sitting, lying back on my bed and watching the fan go over my head. And I could have sworn that like, I could have sworn by it that, like, I actually believed it was happening, but, like, I thought someone was taking my brain and switching it with some kid on the other side of the world, and, like, I was going to end up in his body living his life. And that freaked me out.
Are you serious?
Yeah, no, like, yeah. It freaked me the fuck out. I was sitting there screaming in my bed, like, crying for my mom, like, don't let them take my brain, don't let them take my brain.
Holy shit.
And so imagine being a parent, like, you hear your kid screaming that upstairs, like,
That's crazy, dude. That's never happened to me. I've only taken acid one time.
Acid's not that bad for you, right?
Well, not physically, but you can really trip on that shit.
No, but it's not like coke, right?
What's the come down on LSD like? Is there a come down at all?
Is that acid?
It depends on your...
Yeah. Okay, LSD is acid. Okay, but it depends on your experience. It depends on your experience. So if you had a very terrifying experience, dude, it can be very detrimental to your health, like your mental health, right?
Right.
But in general, like the more like neutral effects that most people feel is kind of like... You kind of feel like you went on a long trip. You know that feeling when you're young and you go, I don't know, you go to like Disneyland and then like you come back home like all tired and you're young, you know, you're very tired. You just want to like...
Sleep.
It feels like you went on this like long trip, right?
Right.
That's how it feels. It feels like you went somewhere else and like, damn, like I'm back.
Is that the same drug that if you take for a long period of time, it gets rid of like your dopamine like receptors and the makes you feel?
Nah, you can't. There's no way that it's because you build a tolerance.
Yeah, so I'm saying
substances.
So you don't.
So you can't really
harder
do it
to get
day.
Happier, like on a normal scale.
Well,
is that what it is, or is that am I talking about another drug?
Well, I think there might be something else.
The thing about
then that's how you end up with a dependency on it.
Yeah, because what do people take at raves?
You can get mentally.
Oh,
like,
you're thinking of E.
Okay, never mind.
Oh,
okay,
that can be psychedelic, but it's not necessarily psychedelic.
Okay, that's a separate drug. That's what I was
It's another
about.
Drug, yeah.
Okay.
Well, ecstasy can be dangerous. I think you're talking about MDMA. Ecstasy is more. Ecstasy is just MDMA combined with like other shit. Like it could be speed, it could be math, whatever, right?
Yeah, wow. Imagine speed with like. A depressant and just like I'm stoked but I'm bummed.
Yeah, it's like meth. They said it's kind of like taking a lot of cocaine and a lot of LSD at the same time.
Wow,
imagine that shit, dude. Like that must be scary, dude. Like, even just LSD can be very fucking scary, dude, because LSD makes you like it makes you forget about like who you are, like it completely memory wipe. It's like if I was like tripping right now then and I was having like a kind of like an ego death, I would forget like who the fuck you guys are. I'd be like in some other like
right.
And I wouldn't even acknowledge you guys.
Yeah, that would trip me out.
Of course, it really depends on the dose and the kind of person that you are. If you're very sensitive to substances like this and then you have kind of like a third eye personality in a way, then you're gonna like experience some crazy shit. Or there are some people who fucking take LSD and it's like whatever. Like the people who are very enlightened. Like if you go to India and like all those places where I read this book, that's called Be Here Now. That's like one of the like classics for like spirituality. It's about this Stanford professor, psychology professor who went to India to like meet a guru and like fucking go on like a crazy spiritual journey, and then he came back with all this knowledge and shit. And while he was there, like he took LSD with him because he used to do a lot of psychedelics like mushrooms and LSD. I don't know his name, but he was like this enlightened being, this like guru that apparently like understands reality, right? He's enlightened, what they call enlightenment. He gave him like a bunch of LSD. He took it like nothing. He's like, what? Like this is nothing.
Like, right, like this is my day game. Like,
exactly. Yeah. This is how I feel all the time. Like I don't understand you. Like why you guys make such a big deal about this?
Uh-huh.
Like imagine that. Like it's fucking crazy. Like if you think about what that means that this guy like LSD has no effect for him. Meaning he's always in this weird state of enlightenment in a way. So I don't know. You could call it psychosis. You could call it. But what is psychosis though? I mean, in a Western world, psychosis has a negative connotation to it. Uh-huh. But in a lot of cultures, like hearing voices and like schizophrenia and all that stuff, is more like for them they make him like, they see it as kind of like in a spiritual awakening.
Mm-hmm.
But isn't that a trip, dude? It's like psychosis or spiritual awakening. For a lot of cultures, hearing voices in your head is kind of like you're the chosen one, and this is you're like the medium between like the spirit world and like this. Physical plane.
See, but then if they see it as just another, you know, perception of reality, would they then try to help that person? Or is because if they don't see it as a problem, like, would they see it? Because, like, in the Western world, it's like any deviation from the, like, the one that's prescribed as the norm needs to be fixed.
Exactly. And
so,
it's frowned upon, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So, like, yes, schizophrenia could be terrifying, but like if someone says, you know, I have schizophrenia, it's not that bad, but I have it, you kind of look at them like, should I hang out with you?
It's because we were programmed to think
even
like this.
Even with just like more of the, I don't want to say like, you know, the not as as extreme, like, because they're definitely still can be debilitating, but like, you know, more commonly accepted mental illnesses like depression or anxiety, like some people still can still look at you and like, because there's still that connotation. It's like, well, you're not healthy, or not even not that you're healthy, it's just you're not normal.
Right. Right. It really depends on your perspective, because like a lot of people are depressed. That's how it is. Like depression is becoming like a big thing, you know? That's because, I mean, like think about where technology is at. Like more and more jobs require less manual labor, more and more jobs require mental labor. It's fucking crazy. Like depression and anxiety and all this shit is going to be the illnesses of the future.
Yeah. I wonder what happens like as the workplace becomes more automated and there's less of the requirement for people to actually work. Like, and if so, if less people work or less people have to work, I wonder how that would affect people's, you know, outlook on life and if they feel more fulfilled or less fulfilled.
Who the fuck knows, man? We'll go into like Wall-E, like the world of
Wall-E. Well, becomes everyone's, yeah.
Wall-E. That's cool.
That's a really underrated movie.
I love that movie.
It was great.
And it's kind of scary too. Like,
yeah, like he's this totally dystopian, like Earth is completely vacant. Except for this cute little robot.
I know, right? And, like, just the way that, like, how the spaceship is ran, and, like, you're like, how? You're not even an individual anymore. You're just, like, a machine. You're part computer.
How is it that you, because they existed there up on the station for, like, hundreds of years, almost, like, 1,000 years, something like that. Like, they've been on this voyage, or what they called it, but, like, they're still able to feed themselves? How does that work? Like, how would you be able to supply people on that kind of a finite space for thousands of years? Like, do you have like a farming spit?
Yeah, they probably do. Like, I don't know. By then, they probably developed some crazy technology, like where they could like 3D print food or some shit.
Yeah.
You know?
Or even now, they're with meat, they're getting like a tissue sample of meat with their DNA and like constructing that into an actual piece of like filet.
Whoa.
Yeah.
That's a trip. Okay.
Oh yeah, they're doing that right now. They're taking a tissue sample and then through whatever means to actually those cells build up, because it's like meat cells, you know, whatever you
right, have. So they can like, it's like stem cells and you can like build something off of that?
Yeah, so they're somehow building, so if you get, it's not going to be an actual piece of like muscle, like you're not going to, it's not going to look like a fucking thigh off a cow or something, but it's going to be flesh, but through genetic means. It's going to be completely natural because it's building off its own cells, but I don't know how they're, like, it's not going to be natural in the way how they grow it, obviously, but it's not going to be like they're putting in some kind of weird chemical. It's just another way of growing the cells, and they've grown it to, like, actual pieces of, so they think in the future that's how they're going to keep up with the meat, the demand of meat, so.
Wow. I could imagine people taking issue with that ethically.
Oh, yeah.
Because, like,
I mean, you're always going to have traditional people, and you're always going to have people who are trying to break through, like, oh, let's get past all the traditional stuff, and that's what happens all the time. It's like the traditional versus the people who are trying to form new ideas.
The more progressive
side of society. I think that's what you need in any sense, because you can't be completely like, oh, let's get rid of the past and go to the future, but it's a balance, and that's kind of like how we are. That's how we've, at least this country has like developed. You've gotten a mix of both, and that's how we've gotten to the point where we are right now.
I was having a discussion with someone. It's how they were about like socialism. Well, like, is not cool for America because we're capitalism. But I'm like, but it would be more beneficial to have a mix of both. Because like unbridled socialism would be just communism.
Yeah.
What unbridled capitalism would be just fascism.
Yeah.
So having a mix of the two to keep themselves in check with each other is more beneficial for everyone because it keeps it from going one side or the other too far.
Definitely. We're in some kind of weird limbo with that right now.
Right. But then back to your point about like having people who are more rooted in tradition and more people who want to try new things, it kind of balances themselves out from just going off on a tangent or staying stuck in one place.
Yeah.
That's it's crazy, though, because, like, if you think about, like, science, where science is at right now, like, think about religion now. I don't know if you guys are religion, like, no judgments or whatever, but religion, in a way, answers all your questions. Like, what happens when you die? Like, why are you here? Who created you?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't let you question anything, right?
And then science came along, right? And it, all these, like, traditional values and all these, like, family structures and social values and social structures, whatever, they've been slowly broken down, mm-hmm. you know, because thanks to science and thanks to knowledge and thanks to the fact that we're getting more and more, like, our consciousness expanded in a way, that it's bringing out a lot of anxiety to a lot of people, if you mm-hmm. think about it, dude, because you're, like, if at the end of the day, like, if you start, like, if you forget, like, why you're here, like, if you don't really understand why you're here, then you're gonna feel like you're, like, in fucking, like, a prison or something, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, stuck in this reality.
Yeah. Right.
Because you can never leave this reality unless you die or something, or you take, you know, psychedelic drugs. That's the only way you can escape this reality.
Uh-huh.
Or meditate and stuff like that, you know?
One of my old high school teachers, that was one of his favorite stories. I'll never forget this. Mr. Curry, he taught Honors Humanities. And I guess, like, people under Roman authority, or who were subjected to Roman authority, were like, they were treated like shit. But when Christianity came along, this idea of the afterlife, like, when you die, you go to heaven. So, like, when it came to threat, like, you know, do what we say or we're going to kill you, people were like, you're going to kill me? Awesome, you'll send me to heaven. And it kind of freaked out the Romans, like, wait, what the fuck? Like, what? You can't just threaten them with death anymore, because that's not the end. So I guess that it's, yeah, it could be a more a comforting thing. So
exactly.
Then when it comes along, it, like, with science, like, saying, like, creationist versus evolutionary. Like, if you see evolutionary theory as being a threat to that, you know, it's kind of like the domino theory. Like, if we let them kind of disprove this one theory, what's to say that the rest of it won't be taken away?
Yeah,
we don't have that assurance or comfort.
Yeah, but you also can, like, really prove the other one either. Like, evolutionary theory, like, there's no, well, we think it is, but this is just theory at the end of the day, you know
right.
what I mean?
But
so
it's,
neither,
but I mean,
it's crazy,
it's
like,
still
neither
up, like, a theory. It's that's where, like, the misconception is, that between hypothesis and theory. Like, hypothesis, I think it went like this.
Mm-hmm.
But a theory is, like, backed up with, like, hundreds of thousands of different
okay.
instances of evidence. Like, we have the fossil records
okay.
showing how
yeah,
different
right.
species progressed.
You're right.
That's
crazy.
So, yeah.
Yeah. I guess what I'm trying to say is that there's no, like, right or wrong way to look at life. If you want to believe that you're created by God and you're going to go to heaven afterwards, it, hey, man, like, you can believe that, you know? But at the same time, like, I feel like the more you read, the more you learn, the more you study, the more you experience, the more you start realizing that, well, maybe religion isn't that correct, you know? And then there's all these things that we don't really understand, and that's okay to not understand. And then you go to other philosophies, like, say, like Buddhism, like, Buddhist philosophy and stuff like that, where it talks about, like, a lot of, that you have to be okay with not being okay, if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm.
Not being okay in the sense that you don't know why we're here and you don't know what your purpose is and you don't even know if there's a meaning to this life. But maybe that's the meaning of the life, you know, to just live.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To just experience it.
Yeah.
That is that. Maybe that's what the meaning is, you know? I don't know. Instead of trying to find a meaning, because you already found your meaning. You're already experiencing the meaning, which
right.
is being here, like, us talking, conversating, sharing all these ideas. That's the meaning of life.
That exactly. search for the meaning is the meaning itself.
Exactly.
That would be true.
Yeah. Who knows? Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of great ideas.
Damn, that went deep.
Well, on that note, we're going to wrap this up.
Yeah.
Well, thanks, Tyler, for being
yeah.
here.
Thank you for having me. This
so, is
fun.
There any way, anything you want to share as far as, like, somewhere where people could follow you or to see your next, you know, EP coming up?
Yeah, most of what I share things is through Facebook. So that's facebook.com/fingerprintsCA, California. And
okay.
yeah.
So through Facebook. All right. And you're saying, when can you kind of guess when? So you're going to be hitting the studio. And then I know from first-hand experience that mixing and stuff takes a couple weeks to months, depending on how long.
Uh-huh.
So you're thinking maybe spring, summer-ish?
Ballparking it, probably this upcoming fall, like October, November, at the latest, maybe.
Oh, really?
If I had to really...
At the latest. Okay.
Yeah. Well, maybe not the latest, but, like,
so,
that sounds roughly, well, sort of, like, end of summer, fall, probably.
Oh, when it's going to be released?
Yeah.
Okay, so you, like, are you done writing, or are you kind of still writing?
I've got two of, like, the three or four that I want done. So it probably will only be three, but I've got two written down and one
right.
that I'm almost
done
complete with. Yeah.
So you're going to be, like, recording, how long do you think is that span, kind of, next April, like, all of April, or...
I don't think it would take more than just a month.
Okay.
I would imagine with just three songs, it should be just, like, get in and be done.
Is it, like, production that's taking the next summer? Like, do you think the production part of it, of, like, mixing it and all that? And you kind of probably want to get, like, the album work
right.
done. So.
I have the album cover figured out.
Oh, okay.
Just, like, just it would be recording it, and then the post production, like mixing, mastering, will
yeah.
probably take a little bit
That'll
while,
take
so
a
just
while.
Like fine tune it
yeah.
to how we want it to go.
Cool. All right, so you can find Tyler's music there, and do you have any of your do you have a Bandcamp you want people to listen to? Or
yeah, Bandcamp.com. Or no, fingerprintsca, again, that fingerprintsca.bandcamp.com is where you can find the demo, and then the EP is going to be on there, too.
Cool.
That'll probably be available for free.
Okay.
And then also, I added Fingerprints to this list of artists. There's this thing going on. I don't know if you guys heard about this guy. He was in this band called Front Porch Step.
Yeah,
you heard about this guy?
Yeah.
Where he was, like, he played on Warped Tour, and I guess, like, he used his pseudo-celebrity to, like...
Something happened, because
all these girls would come to him like, hey, I really like your music, so they'd snap Instagram photos with him and tag him in it, and so he'd go through all the tags and find their number on their Instagram account, and he would like text them and like sex them, like send them nude photos of himself
Whoa.
To girls who were like 14, 15.
Oh shit.
And so that was the whole thing when that came out, and so they kicked him off Warped Tour, but now he's coming back. And so when he announced that, there's this initiative called Bands Take a Stand, I think. I put it up on my Facebook page. So, like...
Bands Take a Stand.
Bands Take a Stand. So, like,
okay.
It's these bunch of bands. They commit for however long they want to do it. And so whatever donations are put on their Bandcamp gets sent to this program called The Voice for the Innocent, which is a platform to empower women and people who are victims of sexual violence. So
okay.
I've added Fingerprints to that. So any donations from here until, you know, for the foreseeable future will just be added to that.
Correct.
It's fun.
That's interesting.
So,
that's a good cause. Okay.
Yeah.
So you can check out his music there. If you want, we post these to our YouTube page. That's where you're probably listening to this. And if you want to, we'll leave a link down in the description if you want to check out our last EP, which we recorded last summer. And we will be coming out with another 4 songs. Probably the earliest April, maybe May. So, you know, look out for that. And, yeah. So, Tyler, we got to do this next, you know, who knows, next couple months, maybe during the summer, to see where you're at with your music. And it'll be pretty cool to see the progress there. Cool. So, thanks for listening, guys. And we'll see you guys next time. See ya.
Peace out.
Lights.